Well, you said it, Chewie.
Where did you dig up that old fossil?
It's a positive film. It has heroes and villains, and that it essentially is a fun movie to watch. It's been a long time since people have been able to go to the movies and see a sort of straightforward, wholesome, fun adventure.
Well, it's a fantasy. It's not science fiction so much as it is space fantasy. And it's about people. It's finally about people and not finally about science.
The story, when you actually put it into words, is only so much nonsense to hang a great visual experience onto. It's the stuff that fairy tales are made of.
Sort of boiling down religion into a very basic concept. The fact that there is some deity or some power or some force that sort of controls our destiny, works for good and also works for evil.
Marvelous, healthy innocence. Great pace, wonderful to look at, full of guts, nothing unpleasant. I mean, people go bang, bang, and people fall over and are dead. But, you know, no horrors. Some wonderful freshness about it, kind of like a wonderful fresh air.
It's got whatever you want it to be. It's pure entertainment. It's like a roller coaster ride, and it can be interpreted as long as you enjoy it, which is the intention.
And welcome back to Generation Skywalker's Those Old Fossils, Episode 16, Darth Vader. Who am I with this evening? I'm with Stu Skinner. Hello, Stu.
Hey, Ninjas.
You excited about this rather special episode we've got tonight?
I am. I am very excited. I just love the Dark Lord. Voldemort.
Behave. And I'm also joined by Dan Burgess. Good evening, Dan. How are you?
Hello there, all good, mate. Very excited to talk Darth Vader.
Yeah, I know. It's a favourite of yours, for sure.
I've got him tattooed on my right arm. That's how big of a fan I am.
Ooh, more on that soon. And Craig. Craig Spivey's joining us to make up the team this evening. Craig, great to see you. How you doing, mate?
I'm good. Locked and loaded.
Sweet.
Prepare the boarding party and set your weapons for stun.
So, Lance, here we are, back again for Those Old Fossils, Episode 16. And I'm really excited about this. This is a slight break from the norm now. Those who are new to this show, Generation Skywalker is an all eras, all passions, all Star Wars celebration of our galaxy far, far away. Myself and Stu, we started off on the Vintage Rebellion podcast back in 2014, but moved on a few years back. But Generation Skywalker has enabled us to expand our field of view, and along with Dan and Craig and a plethora of extra guests, we've delved deeply into a mixture of vintage shows and modern. But we've also explored TV shows, the original trailers, beer tasting episodes, yes, Star Wars beers, commentaries, book months, and even Attack of the Clones special. We've got blogs, unboxings, and pretty much every show has been enhanced. But the main two series from Generation Skywalker are Those Old Fossils and The Modern Way, and you're listening to Those Old Fossils Episode 16. Now, a few months back, we revamped Those Old Fossils and decided to focus on four figures or characters of the original 96 per episode, and it's been absolutely brilliant fun. We've had Matt George, Alex Pardy, Andy Goldin, Ron Salvatore, whole host of guests discussing various different figures from Obi-Wan Kenobi, Dengar, Klaatu, Anakin, Warriors Man, Hoth Rebel Soldier, Biker Scout, and R2 Pop-Up. Now this month we were looking at having the Emperor, the Imperial Dignitary, Emperor's Royal Guard, and Darth Vader. However, Vader was just so big that we've had to dedicate a whole show to the Dark Lord. We're also really blessed throughout this entire series now that we've got the expertise of the variant villains on. So the likes of Mark Andrews, Will Mellish, Jamie Acott, and Mark Baker, who are passionate and knowledgeable and can answer questions on why is this like this and breaking down some of the barriers associated with variants. So here we are, the Dark Lord Show, Darth Vader. Now I'm delighted that during this episode we are joined by the Guinness World Record holding godfather of Darth Vader collecting, Bill McBride.
This will be a day long remembered. It has seen the end of Kenobi and will soon see the end of the rebellion.
Lads, you've listened to the Bill interviews. What are your thoughts?
I was really disappointed I couldn't join you for that, Jez. I was looking forward to it, but I got unexpectedly called to a family barbecue. But yeah, awesome, awesome listen.
If I was on with you, mate, there's no way I'd have let you down for a barbecue.
Okay.
You'd have let him down for a fiver, let's be fair.
Come on, let's talk about Darth Vader.
Baby, let's talk about you and me. Let's talk about all the good things and the bad things that may be. Let's talk about
Lord Vader.
Let's talk about
Vader.
Let's talk about
Darth.
Let's talk about
Vader.
Let's talk about Darth Vader. So as this is a vintage collecting show, I'm going to offer this perspective of Darth Vader as viewed through a mid-80s lens. So in the first movie, Darth Vader was presented to us as an ex-pupil of Ben Kenobi and murderer of Luke's father, Anakin, more machine than man. And it was the design of Darth Vader, a collaboration between George Lucas himself, Ralph McQuarrie, costume designer John Mollow, and sculptor Brian Muir, that instantly established him as an icon of screen villains. Taking some of George's samurai influences and adding some real-world logic to answer how anyone could remain breathing as they passed between ships in the vacuum of space, McQuarrie nailed the look in his first production painting, which was developed with very little changes. Vader was physically portrayed on screen by bodybuilder Dave Prowse, fencer Bob Anderson, and the voice of James Earl Jones, who felt his contributions were so slight that they didn't actually warrant credit on the first two movies. This was later fixed in Return of the Jedi. Although George Lucas claims to have known that Vader was in fact Anakin during the writing of the first movie, there's no actual evidence of this until the early drafts of The Empire Strikes Back from 1978. Regardless of whether it was all part of the plan from the beginning or not, 1980 saw the plot twist to end all plot twists. And irrespective of where you stood in the playground debates, Return of the Jedi not only confirmed the revelation, it redeemed the fallen Jedi. In the original trilogy alone, we see this character develop from a one-note, cape-swishing villain to a conflicted, flawed, damaged human, which is testimony to those who brought him to life in those first three movies. Return of the Jedi's Darth Vader is not quite as sure-footed. His sinister horror movie breathing in New Hope slowly transforms into the wheezing of a man on life support by the end of the trilogy. So much has been added to Vader's story over the past 40 years that it's impossible to view this Dark Lord of the Sith in quite the same light as we did back then. And that's okay.
Mate, that's wonderful. Thank you so much. Lads, what are your thoughts? Darth Vader, is he all that? Did you care much for him? Were you scared as a kid?
Absolutely. He's just the pinnacle for me of everything Star Wars. I mean, even now, you know, we've just had the Obi-Wan series and before that Rogue One. It's just magic in it every time he's on screen. It's that perfect recipe of great costume, great the sound effects that go with him. So he's breathing, the James L. Jones's voice, the size and bulk of David Prowse, who just, you know, just mix it all together and got a, you know, an iconic, not just an iconic Star Wars character, but just a movie, you know, iconic villain in general. You can't think of many villains that outbad Darth Vader. You know, what, Hannibal Lecter? I can't think of too many villains that stand up to the Vader test, to be honest with you.
Yeah.
Yeah, Dan's nailed it. I think he's the most iconic baddie in any movie ever. I mean, just that image of him walking onto Tantive, wasn't it? It was just... Scared a lot. It did scare me. I could have taken him. But...
You see, it was funny because growing up from in Bristol, and Dave Prowse was a Bristol boy, so he was known as the Green Cross Code Man. So I was kind of confused and conflicted as a kid, because it was like, yeah, this is Darth Vader, but this is a guy who plays him and he's trying to help us cross the road, and he's just picked up my mate Michael just in a demonstration of his strength. And yeah, it wonderful to see the actor there. But yeah, what an absolute class character. Absolutely wonderful. And you know, we've got our guest today, Bill McBride. You could just completely see as a child why Bill was just, you know, transfixed and decided that Vader was the way. A lot of us have our heroes is Luke or Han or Leia, but for him, no, absolutely Darth Vader. And as soon as we said that we were putting this episode together, the amount of people contacting us saying, you need to get Bill on. And it's just been brilliant that he's come on and given up his time.
It's quite a scary figure to focus on, isn't it? You look how much, I mean, just looking around my room now, it's like literally everything, not everything, but the majority of items have got Darth Vader on them.
Visually, he was the poster boy of the saga from day one, wasn't he? Quite literally. I mean, the one common element that looms large on every original trilogy Star Wars cinema poster is Vader's helmet. And it's the one character guaranteed to be in every vintage toy line. And that's like that first wave of stuff, everything from the action figures, model kits, the masks, like the bop bags. You know, if you're going to pick one character, it was Vader.
Yeah, absolutely. 100%. A character who can hold his own. But also, you're going to show a stormtrooper, or you're showing Emperor's Royal Guard, or the Emperor. You often do find them joined with Vader as well. Yeah, Vader is omnipresent.
Do you want a fun fact? I know it's a vintage show, but the action figure database at galacticfigures.com shows 122 different releases of 3¾-inch Vader since 1978. Which, when you think about the fact that he's never seen on screen out of his signature kind of look of a black helmet and cape, is pretty good going.
Yeah, I suppose the other fact is, though, they only released one figure between 1977 and 1985, or technically 1995. They've released a lot of Vader since 95.
They made up for it.
Yeah. I think even like the sequel trilogy, you know, like it or loathe it, they knew they wouldn't be able to find or create a villain as good as Vader, so they created one that was just a Vader fanboy, essentially. And I didn't even try to outdo him.
Yeah, still had to say his name, still had to show his helmet.
Mm.
So thinking about it, then having a little look at the original trilogy, do we have any particular favourite scenes or favourite lines?
I think for me, it's such a subtle thing, but I think he's quite witty. Like some of the things he says to some of his underlings, so, you know, apology accepted, Captain Nida, as he's taking him out, or yeah, careful not to choke on your, is it aspirations, Director Krennic, as he's choking right. him. And yeah, you know, just the little witty one-liners that he's got that are quite subtle, but you know, I think they're quite dark and funny.
I'm trying to think of any others now.
But even when he says to Luke, impressive, most impressive, you know, it's just almost a sarcasm in it. I'm sure there's more.
I'm just trying to think of a few now, but there we go, okay.
Even when he's like choking out Admiral Ozzel, and he just starts talking to, he says, you know, you failed me for the last time, and starts choking him, and he just starts another conversation with somewhere else while he's killing the guy below him or above him.
Yeah, a cool character who never failed to surprise. I mean, you saw certain things initially. You just saw the looming, the size of him, the fact that he could force choke, and you know, he could wield a lightsaber, and he could fly in as TIE fighter. But then as we get to Empire, and you see him sort of force pull Han's blaster. And then at the end of Empire, when you see him force throw various different things at Luke on Bespin. Yeah, all that sort of stuff adding to the power behind the Dark Lord, I thought was brilliant.
I think my favourite scene is when he's on Endor with Luke, and they're having that conversation about that name no longer has a meaning for me. And then Luke walks off and he's just staring into the distance. But he's wearing just a mask, but you can just so much emotion there, and it comes through.
What about you, Stu? Craig?
Well, it's an odd one, because I think, you know, today it probably doesn't hold up that well against the lightsaber fights, but I still love the original Ben versus Vader fight on the Death Star. I think it's beautifully shot. Some of the framing and the way it's sort of layered, they're doing that. The Falcon's over in the bay. Our heroes have got to kind of traverse that space to get to the Falcon. Just the way it's all kind of blocked and laid out, I think is lovely. And there's so much in that little exchange of dialogue that just gets added to. And I know, you know, it's like I said in my intro, you know, it's hard to divorce some of the things we've seen since from that moment. But that's always been one of my favourite scenes. Just that image of them with those cross blades, him in the black, Ben in the brown. It just works so well.
Do you know what? We've just mentioned how significant he is on screen and stuff, and you know, the first time you see him on Tantive and whatnot, his presence was so scary. But I can never forget watching Empire for the first time, when he's kneeling in front of the great big hologram of the Emperor, discussing the son of Skywalker. Obviously, at that point, you didn't know that he was Anakin. But yeah, there's something about that scene. I mean, it's a real, probably not a scene any of you boys would have come up with, but.
What, humanised him? Is that what you're saying?
Yeah, kneeling in front of Emperor. There was someone above him, which was the first time we'd really seen it. But also just discussing Luke, which we just know now that he's Luke's father. But at that point, they're talking about this lad and the son of Skywalker. It was just throwing extra little bits in there. If he could be turned, he would be a powerful ally. Just a great moment. And the very first time he speaks, when he's talking to Leia, just that James Earl Jones voice booming out, and kind of amazing moment.
It was scary. There was something about it, wasn't it? It was just the power, the control, the finger point, and he had a good finger point. Yeah, dominant.
I mean, it's quite funny. You know, I've been doing the TikTok videos. It's quite a charming video, which I found, with David Prowse being interviewed. And he's saying that, George Lucas did want me to do the voice, but it was too expensive to fly me to America, so they just used a local voice actor, James Earl Jones. And I thought, no, they used him for a reason, not, you know what Prowse was like, I love him as much as you love him. But
yeah,
it's quite a funny little video. Obviously,
I think it was in Empire of Dreams, they showed the raw footage of him talking with in the mask, and I think it was Mark Hamill said they nicknamed him or someone on the crew, they nicknamed him Darth Farmer because of his Bristolian accent.
This is a consular ship. We're on a diplomatic mission.
Start tearing the ship apart piece by piece until you find those tapes. Find the passengers of this vessel. I want them alive.
Brilliant.
Tell you what, I'm not a prop collector or consider myself in that kind of realm. I don't chase replicas and things like that, but I was offered up a Don Post helmet from the early 90s. And this is the one that they gave them access to, the Empire Strikes Back helmet, and they molded it directly from that screen used piece. And it's sort of, it's fiberglass. You can see the way it's been kind of remolded, the fingerprints on the inside of the helmet. And it's not something I would ever sort of think, well, that's on my, you know, at the top of my list to go and buy. But I encountered this thing in real life in a shop, and I tell you what, that thing has got some presence. When you see it at the size it is, in that chunky material fiberglass, that thing must have, when that first rolled out on set, people must have just been in awe of it. As an object, it's got so much power. It's an incredible thing. And yeah, I ended up buying it, obviously. So I wouldn't be talking about it. But I just think the whole kind of design of that, the gravitas it's got sort of built into it, it's just, yeah, it's lightning in a bottle.
Was that an Empire Strikes Back helmet, you say?
Yeah, so it's got
the New Hope one was even bigger, and you can see, you know, there is something with Vader's costume how it changes film to film, but the one they originally made for New Hope, they made it too big and it had to be padded out inside to fit around his head, and they obviously created a more refined mold for Empire and then Jedi.
The
New Hope one must have been absolutely colossal.
Yeah, we're only getting part of the story seeing it sort of second hand on the screen. I think to be in its presence must have been something.
Yeah, absolutely. And I completely get why these things subtly change. Nothing to do with the fact that, you know, they're made differently or a couple of years later. You know, in the real world, you could find that, you know, in your job, uniforms may change this and the other. My helmet, which I have of work, I think I'm on my fourth helmet. So I understand, as Darth Vader's gone through a New Hope era, and they might, you know, put it out to a different manufacturer, you know. It all goes out of tender. Three different sort of companies are saying, yeah, we'll manufacture this for you, and, you know, it goes to competition. And obviously the government or the Empire buys the cheapest one they can. So
you know what it's like, Jez. Your old master tracks you down and cracks your mask open, and you've got to get a new one.
The Emperor will show you the true nature of the Force. He is your master now.
Well, seeing as we love this figure so much, this character, and there is a great deal of love for it, let's talk about the figures. Let's talk about how it came out. So, yep, as we know, the original 12 line. So on Tracker, there have been 3 DT carded figures sold in the last 12 or so years, most recently at the Hakes auction in 2020 for $47,200, which was an AFA 75, which was cheaper than the one the year before. Again, another AFA 75, this with a plus after it, for $62,000. And the first one, $64,000 for an AFA 70 in 2018. Now, we're not going to go into any more details about DTs, double telescoping sabers, because there are some experts far more informed than I who are going to be briefing about those later on. An AFA 95 at Hakes in 2018, Darth Vader sold for $19,470, an AFA 95. You've got the Toll Toys absolute standout piece at Vectis in September 21 for $12,000. So again, you go through all of the different ones, Harbors, Leddies, the 14 and the 30s, the Tops Toys, the Toll Toys, the PPP, the Secuda, the various different Meccanos, so the Square and Return of the Jedi ones, the Clippers, the Glassleets, the Power of the Force, absolutely stunning. But again, it's not only Kenner A, B and C, but you've got Takara A, B and C as well. So absolutely sensational range of Darth Vader figures.
Impressive. Most impressive.
I'm delighted to be able to cut to the first interview which we've got with Bill McBride, and where we're going to talk initially with Bill to find out a little bit more about the man behind the collection and how he goes about collecting.
Hello there. Come here, my little friend. Don't be afraid.
So I'm absolutely delighted to be joined this evening by lifelong Star Wars fan and someone who I calculate has been collecting Darth Vader items for over 30 years. Bill McBride, welcome to Generation Skywalker.
Oh, thank you so much. Thanks for having me on.
And Bill, there are so many questions I'd like to ask with regards to your collection and your collecting journey. But first of all, I want to know a bit more about you. So you first saw Star Wars around about the age of 6, is that right?
Yeah, I first saw Star Wars. Yeah, I was probably about 6 at the time. I grew up in the country in Virginia, right outside of DC. Well, I guess when it was still country, at least. And yeah, going to movies was like our big, it truly was our main huge source of entertainment. So yeah, fortunately I got to see it as soon as I think it came to our area.
Wonderful. Now, I've seen various different interviews and TV spots where you've said that you immediately had this sort of love or connection with the original bad boy Darth Vader, you know, you straight away as soon as he came on. Yeah, that guy's awesome. But what were your thoughts on the other principal characters, and, you know, Luke and Han? And
oh, I mean, it's you fall in love with all of them. I mean, you really do. I mean, that's the genius, that's the magic of the original Star Wars. It's everybody fell in love with everybody else. It's like you know, Han Solo, Chewie, Leia, Luke, I mean, the droids, it was just, they were all magical. They really were. I don't ever recall a time in my life where I was like, you know, you're kind of mentally detached at a point, but it's like, you know, I don't ever recall a time in my life where I'm like, you know, that character kind of sucked and stuff like that. I think it's ironic actually now that a lot of people and, you know, a lot of modern fans or people that are always sort of pushing, we need these like super strong female characters and they got to do this and this. And it's like, bro, I grew up with that. It's like Carrie Fisher was Princess Leia. There was nothing weak about that character. So it's like, come on. But I just don't know. I don't know. I think it was a combination of everything about the character of Vader. You know, the way he's presented visually. It's like, you know, you have the tint of the white hallway, the stormtroopers, and all of a sudden this huge menacing guy comes out and, you know, all black, and it was just crazy. I don't know what it was. It was just absolutely enamored with the character, but yeah. Even from a little age, I definitely loved Vader.
I guess when you walk in with that John Williams music as well, it's just like, right, this is the big bad guy right now with that symphonic background. Yeah, I'm with you loud and clear on that. Did you get to experience the whole of the sort of Vader, Luke arc and all of that going through? Did you see the films in order? Because I know from my childhood, I, funnily enough, saw Jedi before Empire. Did you get to go to the cinema for each movie?
Oh, well, yeah, absolutely. Yeah. That was that probably aged me as a child because, you know, we experienced it, you know, that's like that real time firsthand deal. So it's like you're walking out of Star Wars going, that is literally the most life changing movie I've ever seen. And then, you know, through like newspaper articles, stuff like that, we started hearing rumors about, you know, hey, Star Wars 2. You know, there's Star Wars 2. Star Wars 2 is in the works. And it's like, whoa, they're doing another one? And so, yeah, I mean, everybody's like super hype about it. We're just chomping at the bit to go see it. And then you go see Empire. And you walk out of Empire with just like, wow. And then, you know, what the hell just happened?
Yeah,
that was just kind of crazy. And then, yeah, so then you're just, again, it was almost a foregone conclusion that there's going to be a Star Wars 3. And, you know, long haul, sure enough, we found out it was going to be, oh, Revenge of the Jedi, and then hits the theater, and I think everybody forgot about that. So, yeah, just got to see Return, and it was crazy. Yeah.
Brilliant. So that whole moment, no, I am your father, you got to see that as it should have been released at the cinema. Fantastic. Brilliant. Mate, I'm just going to go off slightly now, because one thing you and I both have is a military connection. I'm aware that you served in the US Marine Corps, I believe it was, and without prying too much into your service life, do you find many sort of crossovers with Star Wars whilst in the military, or is it strictly separate? I say that because I've seen so many crossovers, names, call signs, formation call signs, morale patches. You know, we've even got, well, there's a US spy plane called Vader.
Yeah.
Did you have much of a connection, or did you keep those two aspects of your life, you know, and career separate?
I think actively, you know, I was, you know, when I was on leave and things like that, I would always try to hit up like antique stores or look for the toy stores and stuff like that. Actively, you know, it really, I think when I was in, there wasn't that much. It was, you know, what we traditionally call in the hobby as far as the dark times, you know, there really wasn't a lot of Star Wars content. It wasn't necessarily in the public, in the common vernacular. So it wasn't as pervasive as it is now. I think we had some old school stuff, you know, like a couple things that weren't, that I was aware of, but, you know, directly, no, I don't really think there was too much crossover there.
Right. Yeah. Okay. I get the whole dark time things. You know, when I first joined, there was definitely, I was almost keeping it a bit more on the down low, but as the sort of time's gone on, it's pop culture and everything like that, it's just got cooler and cooler and cooler. So, okay. Thanks very much for sharing that.
Oh yeah. I mean, absolutely. It's almost, I mean, there's times where I, you know, now looking back, and because patches are a part of my collection as well. And so, yeah, it's like, there's these things I'll, you know, surf eBay or see something pop up that I wasn't aware of. And I'm like, you know what, that is really cool, man. I wish we would have had something like that when I was in. I've said that a lot.
Yeah.
So yeah, definitely jealous of that.
Okay. Now, from a collecting point of view, we're going to go on to the collection and various different things, but my hero growing up was Mark Hamill, and I couldn't wait to get his autograph at Celebration Europe 2 in Essen, Germany. How do you feel about the likes of Prowse, James Earl Jones, and we'll come on to Hayden and sort of Spencer Wilden, etc., but are these as much important to you as the collectibles?
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, it's one of the things I absolutely treasure, and I really still, I mean, to this day, excites me the most about what we do and, you know, how we operate as collectors is really getting the history behind it. You know, it's just like, because there's a large part of my collection that's props. So a good analogy would be the original Vader helmet is just massive. It's huge. Unless you've never seen like a one-to-one scale replica, you can't appreciate really how big this thing is. And that was one of the thoughts I always had, is like, what was that like to wear on set? I mean, that had to suck. So I remember the first time I met Dave Prowse, we had this whole conversation about it. Like, I mean, man, what was this like? And he's like telling me these little anecdotes and these little stories about things that happened on set. And it was just awesome. But yeah, I love meeting, you know, having the opportunity to interact with those, you know, with those actors and the people that contributed, you know, especially like James Earl Jones. I've been fortunate enough to actually meet him twice and, you know, had him sign things. And just these people are just amazing. It's, you know, it's kind of like there's no doubt why, at least in my mind, why Vader is such an impactful, world recognized, just a significant character. When you look at the sum of his parts are all made up of these world class talents. I mean, it's just amazing. So yeah, I love it. Unfortunately, I have not had an opportunity to meet really any of the modern era Vader actors that have contributed, but I'm, you know, definitely looking forward to it.
I'm so delighted that you've got to meet David Prowse, and of course you would have done. You're Bill McBride, you know, and James Earl Jones. I was thinking to myself, you know, they must have connected. They must have got together. Okay, that's awesome. But it links me quite nicely, actually, into something with regards to the prequels, because there was an article which I read, and I'll quote, it says, "Recall his dislike for the prequels. Bill was quick to point out that his love for Vader is the powerful Sith Lord is, you know, in armoured form. Bill owns a few Vader collectibles, a very brief scene in the grand scheme of things, but he stresses that Anakin Skywalker, played by Hayden Christensen, doesn't enter the equation." So it seemed when this was written that you were absolutely sort of very strongly in the OT. The prequel trilogy hadn't quite sort of, you know, worked for you at that stage of your life. But I've noticed that people seem to have softened to the prequels over the years, but maybe even since, you know, the Disney era. So has your acceptance of the prequels and Hayden changed?
I think just to be clear about Hayden, it absolutely had nothing, you know, it was not directed at him personally or questioned anything that he did. It was just within the context of what I was trying to express, I guess, because, you know, my initial realm of experience and sort of my mental image, everything that was burned into my head was just Vader in the suit. And that's all that ever existed for me. So I think the Anakin Skywalker as he became Darth Vader prior to getting in the suit kind of deal, I think there's a detachment there for me. But having said that, it's, you know, somebody actually, it's funny you say this, because I had a conversation with somebody, it was probably like 4 or 5 months ago, and we were just kind of going back and forth through the whole, you know, the prequel thing. And he actually pointed out made a really good point. It's like, if you can contextualize the prequels as the rise of Emperor Palpatine and the rise of Vader and how he became Vader, then it's definitely a lot more interesting. I just think I'm kind of like a huge movie fan. So it's like, there's certain things that I still have problems with the original trilogy, but yeah, at the end of the day, it's like, you know, I tell people it really doesn't matter. I mean, if it's something that you like and it entertains you, then it's all good. I have no argument with that. I really don't. It's just like we have this crazy toxicity in our fandom where people are like, oh, hey bro, I kind of like this thing. And instead of the immediate is like, oh, wow, man, that's really cool. I mean, he's not my guy, but I mean, that's really cool. This is this media, like this viciousness, like, oh, you're stupid. That's, why do you like that? That's stupid. And I honestly have never understood that, you know, like the prequels. I mean, there's certain elements, I guess that's my point. It's like certain elements I can extract from that to appreciate, I mean, not really going to be my thing, but it's just, like I said, man, it's all good. It's all Star Wars. You know, you like it.
Yeah.
Cool. If you don't like it, that's cool too.
Absolutely. No, I've completely warmed to the prequel trilogy over the last few years, actually. And you know, the more I see it, the more I see it linking in. And I think also, I also see it when we go off to celebrations and various things, and you're just immersed with various different generations, and the prequel are their first sort of look at Star Wars. And
oh, yeah.
When you're surrounded by the fan base, I know what you said about, you know, the toxicity, etc., but they're just the vocal minority, aren't they? I find that you go away, you see something like Celebration, you come back, and it's just like, wow, you know, PT's brilliant. You know, I was at one panel, and there was just people there who were so up for Rebels and the Clone Wars, and it made me sort of get caught up in their own venturi of excitement, and it sort of opened my eyes a little bit more. So no, that's cool. I get it. When we move away then from OT slightly, you know, Vader now, as our galaxy far, far away is enhancing and growing and more stories are being told, what do you think of Kenobi, or Rogue One for that matter?
Oh, I love Kenobi. I mean, it's like, as an actor, I love Ewan McGregor. He is just, the guy is ridiculous. I mean, everything, it seems like everything he does is just awesome. So obviously you could not have done that without him. It was just, that was just a no-go. I think that would have been some true fan anger if they would have tried that. But no, I love Kenobi. I loved, you know, Hayden's portrayal of Vader. Everything about it. To me, there just weren't really kind of any weak spots in that. And then, yeah, I got to say, Rogue One is probably, definitely up there in the top five of all Star Wars movies for me. So,
Bill, we're completely on the same page. Absolutely. We very recently did the Generation Skywalker review of the Kenobi TV show, where we've gone into it, really sort of stripped it down, analysed it, and given our opinion and observations. And yeah, the Kenobi show, I mean, yeah, breathtaking and so good, added so much more. And I felt that it linked all three trilogies together. There were certain things which are happening, which then sort of opened up into the sequel more. And obviously it was that bridge between the PT and the OT. I just thought it was wonderful. And yeah, who doesn't love Rogue One? So moving on to the collecting then side of it, you know, we've established that you began collecting at an early age and it just hasn't stopped. You are known as the man who is in the Guinness Book of Records for the largest Vader collection in the galaxy. So tell us, how did the Guinness Book of Records come about? And please take me back to the beginning of your collecting journey.
I actually come from, a family of collectors. Growing up, my father was, you know, a prolific collector with, you know, in his own right. So I started off pretty early, you know, had the collecting bug, and, you know, I was of the mind to, you know, that's, going forward, that was kind of the mindset I had. And after Star Wars came out, I remember going to the store and I saw the 15 inch Vader, the big guy, and the 4 inch one, and I just flipped out. I was like, you know, because your parents are like, okay, you can only get one thing, and it was instinctive. I didn't even look at anything else. I just wanted the Vader toy. So I think that's kind of where things started off. And then, of course, you know, going through life, you have ebbs and flows to, you know, what you do and don't have time for. But yeah, I think it's just always an instinctive thing. It was very organic. You know, when I really started collecting very seriously as an adult, yeah, it was kind of crazy to me, because I had a lot of people that were like, oh my God, why are you only collecting one thing? It's kind of, you know, all the stuff you're passing up. I'm like, well, I said, man, I don't have money for everything else. It's like, I just want to collect what I want to collect. And that's the way I've always done it. It's like, you know, say if it's something I really want, then I'm going to collect it. If it's something I don't want or I don't like, then it's almost like no amount of kind of hype or selling it up to me is ever going to work. It's just, I just don't process stuff like that. I don't know. It's like, I think the whole, you know, the whole record thing started with, it was obviously inspired by Steve Sansweet, because he has his insane, you know. I don't know. If he went through and actually counted up his Vader stuff, he's probably got more than I do. So, you know, just to be honest about it, I'm sure he's got me beat as with that as well. But it was just, I don't know, some friends were just talking about it and like, oh man, it'd be kind of cool and see what you got. And it's just started, you know, digging in my spreadsheets and, you know, all my notes and stuff like that. And it's kind of what really started it. And then just, I don't know, just pursued it, I guess, for no other reason, just to, you know, use up some non-existent free time I had at the time. But yeah, I guess that's how it started.
Right. Okay. So then you go through the application process. Guinness is saying, right, do this. I mean, that must have taken ages to catalog everything and send it off to them.
It was actually, there's a couple different sort of stages that you go through. You have to basically be able to substantiate your claim. And you can do that with, actually what helped me a lot were a lot of the documentaries and videos and things like that. I mean, you can't approach them by saying, hey, you know, I get a million Pez dispensers. Okay, well, prove it. That's basically the process.
Yeah.
You know, it's like you can make a claim to something, but it's like, let's go ahead and see that. You know, you have to be able to quantify, you know, you have to be able to substantiate the statement. Then it's like, you know, you have to give them some proof. And like the documentaries and all the other stuff that I was so fortunate to have done at the time, that really helped that, because, you know, you're showing people stuff and you're like, yeah, that's a lot of stuff. That's the usual response. So yeah, it's it can be tedious, but I was also very fortunate with that process.
Fantastic. So I assume then that you were in the annual and you got given a certificate, a framed certificate, which is in the Vader Vault.
Yeah, it's, actually it's not in the current Vader Vault, but, yeah, it's one of these days, I guess when I get some room, I'll have that out on display. So
cool. I've seen various different videos. I think at one stage they said, yeah, 64,000 items. And then as time's gone on, I think the last one I saw, it said it was up to 70,000 when you had to move over to Texas, southeast Texas. So I'm assuming that it's pretty much leveled off now. I mean, would you say it's 70,000, or how big is the collection today?
We'll go with that, because I just, you know, unfortunately it's just lately, you know, the pace of collecting things like that has dropped off precipitously. So it's, haven't had a lot of time to kind of delve into that. And, you know, unfortunately the bulk of the collection's in various storage rooms. So, I think at some point it'd be fun to go back and count, but honestly I don't know. It's one of those things that's like, you show people and it's like, oh man, it's like you're expecting this crazy amount of like visually impressive stuff. And then you realize like, well, it actually is made up of a bunch of little stuff. So it's a little bit more tedious to sort of count and catalog and all that good stuff.
But then nevertheless, 70,000 component
parts. That's a lot, man.
That's pretty impressive. I mean, impressive enough that if I'm right, someone offered you a rather sporty car just for a few of those items. Is that correct?
Yeah, it was a guy who was interested at the time. He wanted a couple different. I have a fortunate to have a pretty good run of vintage Vader prototype material, and he wanted two pieces out of that, and actually offered my favorite car ever, Porsche 911. And I turned him down.
Right, yeah, that's not the sort of room sales type transaction that I've seen in the past, or anything on Hake's auction. Other auctions are available, but yeah, to offer you the keys to a sports supercar, then yeah, that guy must have really wanted that, but you turned him down.
Well, I think it was funny because, well, I mean, I shouldn't say funny. It was just more of an interesting social exchange, because yeah. I thought I've just never approached things from an investment point of view. You know, I've just always collected things that I like, but you know, having said that, in the state of the market and then the rate of prices and, you know, just the astronomical values that, I mean, even to me are basically common stuff that I probably, like at this stage of my collecting, I just would never even look twice at. And you see what they go for and you're like, what the hell? It's like,
yeah.
I mean, it blows me away. It's like, it's funny because when I turned down, I said, look, there are certain things I spend money on and certain things I don't. But I said, if I were to purchase this brand new from a dealer, the second that my signature's on the, you know, on the agreement, and I put the car, you know, put the ignition in, drive off the lot, I've immediately lost money. So why would I exchange something to you that I know is a sound investment, you know, with today's prices, obviously.
Yeah.
And I'm not going to lose money on it. So basically it's like, we do an even exchange, I'm immediately losing money on this. So it's like, that's not really not an attractive situation for me.
I get that entirely. And that makes complete sense to me. So collection wise, we're going to come on to it shortly, but I know that naturally it's not just vintage, is it? It's all Vader's throughout the years. So modern items probably now are playing more and more of a significant role in your collection. Would that be true to say?
Oh yeah. I mean, it's like I said, it's, I mean, my hard and fast rule for my collection is I only, you know, seek those items that I truly like. Like when I see something that I'm like, that is really cool, then I'm going to go get that. There's other things, you know, my most famous example I've used before, I think, is the Mr. Potato Head Vader crossover. For some reason, and my apologies if you're hearing this and it's like your favorite thing ever, but it's like one of those things I just hate it. I absolutely hate it. I think it's because sort of the singular approach to my collection, it's just Vader. It's just, hey, the Vader in the suit, you know, that's kind of the purity of it. But it's like, yeah, that the Potato Vader crossover just made me nuts. I hated it. But yeah, there's so much new cool stuff that comes out. I mean, it's so definitely collect a lot of modern stuff too.
Is there a particular, I mean, Vader is sort of, is omnipresent, isn't it, within everything? I mean, you look at it, you go through the Gus and Duncan's book and you look at various different things. Is there anything in particular which Darth Vader hasn't got to, you know, carrots or grapes, or, you know, is there anything out there that you think, yeah, they've missed a trick there?
Well, it's, you know, it's funny you say it, because it's one of the things when I used to give tours for my collection, I would tell people, you know, hey, your challenge is throw something out there at me, like common household item, just, you know, normal day-to-day sort of life hold, you know, life consumable goods, and throw something out at me that you think has or hasn't been made, you know, and there's not a Vader version of it. And I really can't think of too much that hasn't been done. I mean, there's, just like recently, I found out there's a Darth Vader Instapot. So,
right.
Yeah, it's there is some crazy stuff. I think, they're off the top of my head, I think the probably the two craziest things, or the most, I think, odd things in terms of what you would see Vader on, the Darth Vader condoms. I guess you classify those as bootlegs, but those were actually produced by the designer, Mark Echo. He's obviously a massive Star Wars fan and, you know, came out with a whole line of Star Wars themed clothing, things like that. Well, he made these things up as, like, you know, swag for a show. And he started handing them out. Well, I guess Lucasfilm got a hold of it and they're like, no, we're not doing this. So I guess they confiscated them. But yeah, a few of them made it out. So there's that. There's Darth Vader cologne from Spain. That's another, it's another huge standout, and no offense to my Spanish friends, but this cologne is, it would make Axe body spray, you know, smell like Dior. It's just, it's horrific. Right. I mean, you could probably use it as like an animal repellent or something, but it's actually, I mean, the cool thing about it is the presentation is really neat. You know, it's like this little figural bottle, and, you know, it's in this helmet shaped case, and, you know, the presentation of it's awesome. Just that's as far as I'd ever take it.
Yeah, I'd seen, as I said, a few videos, the Spanish cologne, yeah, and the condoms or Johnny's, but the vacuum cleaner, checkbook, a Vader checkbook,
checkbook covers. let me see, the Japanese, a lot of the Japanese products, they're probably on the top of that sort of, you know, not mainstream type of item. There's actually an all-in-one coffee machine, Darth Vader themed coffee machine. Yeah, I mean, it's tough. I mean, it's actually, you have to think about something that is out there floating around that doesn't have Darth Vader on it or a Darth Vader version of it.
Now I've got a couple of questions here from the guys on the team actually, and Craig said, I've got a left field question, but something that genuinely would bother me if I had thousands of Vader items. Does all the black on black bring additional display issues? And do you have sort of multi-directional lighting? Do you have to create space around the items so it's not just a mass of black? Or, in other words, have you got any display tips for lots of solid black items?
Oh, absolutely. That's a great question. Yeah, 100%. It is a huge challenge. You know, like I said, I mean, I've been fortunate enough to be involved with a few documentaries and films and things like that. And I can tell you from their point of view, professionally, it is a huge challenge. You know, I've had some of the DPs come in and they're like, they walked in like, whoa, it's like, yeah, we're going to need more lights. So it's lighting is a huge issue because it's finding a balance between what I want to do is in a display aesthetic versus, you know, the curation and preservation of something. Yeah, like absolutely. Light is just going to, yeah, light damages everything all the time. There's nothing you can get away with it. So the best thing to do is, you know, obviously mitigate, you know, as far as any sort of direct sun or UV exposure. And then also it's definitely a challenge to get, you know, the right lighting, you know, getting the display set up. I think I definitely, like I said, that's a great question because the other key is actually space, is really trying to, you know, and that's something that I was guilty of in the past is like, you know, there's so much stuff and you want to try to display it all, but you're not really honoring or sort of, you know, promoting the piece if it's just surrounded by like 20 other things. It's like, you have to give it room. You have to give it the respect of what it is by saying, you know, hey, this is a really cool piece. I'm going to give you some air to breathe. So yeah, it's definitely a challenge. I mean, it's just, it definitely eats up a lot more space than you'd ever believe. Like, you know, somebody could go to IKEA and buy 10 Detolf cases and say, oh man, I'm just going to fill these things up. And it's like, even like super high end stuff, you start filling them in and making up, you know, the appropriate display for it. And yeah, your just space evaporates. I try to use a combination of like LEDs, you know, I can just turn on and off at demand. And then, but otherwise, no, I try to keep things fairly dark. I'm so worried about my stuff getting damaged or, you know, a little light creeping in and, you know, messes something up that I just can't repair. And it's, you know, but yeah, that's a really good question. It's yes. So short version, it is a huge challenge.
All right. And you mentioned damage just now, and we've already spoken about, you know, moving the house. And when you have a collection like you do, you must think about insurance, and that must be an absolute challenge for you and your insurers. So if you've got any sort of tips or a plug for a particular insurance company, I mean, how does one even start?
Well, I use a collector's insurance agency, and they're really good. I haven't had any problems. I guess the only thing for me is items above a certain dollar value, you have to basically categorize and you have to send them an itemized list. But otherwise, no, it's kind of based on, you know, whatever quote you had taken out originally for the collection. And I think it accrues at like 10% a year, something like that. So
right.
It's you definitely want to do that, but I'm also like super, super careful when I move stuff, just, you know, hyper paranoid about doing any kind of damage because there's a lot of stuff that I have that is either like a one of a kind or two of a kind. And you just can't risk any, they just won't suffer any kind of damage. You just can't allow it. So I tend to like overpack, kind of like overdo it when I'm moving stuff, but yeah, it's a very stressful process no matter how you kind of work it.
Yeah, but it's bad enough when I've had to move house here with my collection, let alone 70,000 items. Yeah, I don't envy you for that, really. So, well done. We'll move on. And move on we did, but we'll get to that later on. So now, delighted that once again, we've got the variant villains to come along and talk to us about all the different intricacies of Vader, to talk about everything you need to know about the sabers.
Ever since the beginning, to keep the world spinning, it takes all kinds of kinds. All kinds of kinds. All kinds of kinds. All
right, Jez, it's Jamie from Variant Villains. I'm here today with Mark. How are you, Mark?
I'm well, mate. I'm well. I'm really looking forward to hearing everything you've got to say about Darth Vader.
I don't think I'm going to be doing the talking, Mark. I think I'm going to be leaving that all to you.
Hey, wait, what? It feels like a work in progress, so hopefully everything we cover here is accurate. There's a lot of information which I'm going to talk about here with scar types and different licensees. I think people would be best off directed right from the outset to have a look at the Variant Villains website and to look at the information here graphically, where you can actually see different scars and different sort of ways of removing COOs and different saber types. So the sections I'll point you towards, obviously beyond the Vader accessories pages, I would recommend people check out the knowledge, our section under introduction to COOs, and also the page on COO terms. That will just give you a bit of a shortcut.
At this stage, we normally talk about what factories did Vader or did the figures, but with Vader it feels a bit more like we should be talking about which factories didn't do Vader. I mean, he was produced by Kada, Unitoy, Smile, Taiwan, Lily Letty, POC, PBB, Glasslight, Top Toys, even Takara. I mean, you know, what a beast he is.
He's one of the toughest figures
to complete a full run on, purely based on the volume of output across factories and across the entire scope of the vintage era.
He is big, isn't he? I mean, we're going to be talking for a little bit longer than usual.
Okay, well, the earliest producers for Vader were the Unitoy and Kada factories. These were made with Hong Kong COOs, and there's also a made-in-Hong Kong COO for the Unitoy figure. There's a Smile factory, which did a very, very short run of Hong Kong COO figures. Then beyond that, you've got a Taiwan, which made their made-in-Taiwan figure. The Kada and Unitoy are both the most prolific for Darth Vader.
I was going to say, do you think there's any way to identify the different Vader Kenner variants without looking at the COOs?
The chest buttons are probably the easiest thing. You can see on the Kada ones, the buttons are fairly thick. They're very long, thick rectangles, whereas the Unitoy sculpt has a much thinner. And the paint application is a bit different as well. The Unitoy ones tend to be a little bit more of a crimson red, and the Kada ones a bit more of an orangey red.
I mean, if I was having to hazard a guess about the Unitoy, I would say that the made in Hong Kong is the earliest variant. Of course, at the moment, I'm just speculating. But if you look at the other figures in the initial 12 run, the Chewie, the Leia, the Ben, they all had a made in Hong Kong stamp. And I wonder if that's like the earliest iteration of the Vader as well.
Yeah, I wish we could have Tim Emerson on to join us, because he's the one that's looked into this the most with Darth Vader, and especially the early figures. Yeah, the Made in Hong Kong, I suspect as well, it comes with a flat transition lettered saber. And yeah, as you say, the COOs tend to match up with the other figures around it from that sort of same period. So the Made in Hong Kong Unitoy seems to be one of the first ones produced.
What are we talking about when we say DT lightsaber?
Okay, a double telescoping is a two-part saber, and there's an outer part that's got a long cylinder that projects from Vader's hand. And then the second part is like a long, thin needle, I guess you could call it, and that's pushed through the cavity in the center of the first, and that is actually your double telescoping action. Now, this is a very first version of the lightsaber that was made. There's not many of these in existence. Very original ones that were made, they had letters stamped into the hilt of the saber, and there's a number of letter combinations that you can get. I won't go into it all here. The reason they added these letters is to differentiate the cavities within the mold themselves. If you had any malfunctions or any inefficiencies within that tool, it was a shortcut for them to be able to go straight to that particular part where there was a fault, look at the letters and go, okay, well, that's cavity NN. Let's take a look at that and tidy it up a little bit or clean it, or if, you know, whatever was required to get it working.
Awesome. At this point, do we know anything about which factories produced the double telescoping lightsaber?
Just Kada, as far as I'm aware, for Vader. Luke had two factories, Kada and Unitoy, but Ben and Darth, just Kada.
Okay, you mentioned that it was extremely fragile. The run was really short-lived. At that point, I understand that double telescoping lightsaber was ditched and they replaced it with a single telescoping lightsaber, and those were lettered at that point. Do you want to go into more detail?
The lettering is for the same purpose as before. Just the single telescoping, there was no movement within it. So the saber itself was just one piece, and it had a small little needle-like extension which disguised the fact that they couldn't hide the entire lightsaber up the figure's arm. So the bit that stuck out was just a very small needle-like extension, but it was all one piece. It didn't have this two action maneuver required anymore. So the saber itself was just pushed forwards and backwards by the hilt under the figure's arm. So hence single telescoping.
You mentioned Taiwan briefly. Should we delve into that a little bit?
Just the regular made in Taiwan is fairly commonly found mostly in the US. The Made in Taiwan figure has a different sculpt again, and then another one which is much, much harder to find, which is a Taiwan-only COO. What I mean by that, it just has the word Taiwan on the back. Not Made in Taiwan, just Taiwan. That turns up in Australia. The capes that come with it have a unique texture to them. It seems to be that Toll Toys have picked up from the Asian producers when they were ordering their stock. Whether it was cheaper because of the faults, who knows? But yeah, so that's the Taiwan-only version of Vader. The other Asian factory we haven't discussed yet is Smile, which was one of the Hong Kong-based producers and later Macau-based producers. Their version of Vader, we assume that this is a Smile figure. Quite a hard one to find as it goes, which is unusual because Smile is one of the most prolific producers that Kenna had. Perhaps they came in a bit later after Unitoy and Kada. So when they did their very short run, it was just a very small window, only a certain number produced, and that's your lot. So yeah, that's quite a tough one to find.
Great information again, Mark. Just for clarification, you mentioned that Taiwan was the tapered. Kada and Smile, I believe, had the round tip transition and Unitoy the flat tip. Is that correct?
That is correct, yes.
Brilliant. It's great to finally be understanding some of this variant chat. Thanks very much. So, Stu, we've spoken about the carded figures. What about the additional Vaders? What about the two packs, the three packs? The mailers. What else is there, mate? What other multi-packs have we got, or extra packs?
As you probably know, there are a lot of multi-packs and a lot of mailers, and it was involved in two packs, three packs, multi-packs. The old Darth Vader figure appeared in. There's no way I can go through all of it, so what I've done is I have cherry-picked the bits and pieces that, one, I think need covering, and two, that have intrigued me. Now, first of all, Jez, last year you picked up your amazing four-pack with the Italian header. I know you had the Emperor's Royal Guard set, which is beautiful. Now, this pack, I've not seen this one. I saw it in Gus and Duncan's Star Wars Collectibles book, and that is Darth Vader coming with a Paplu, a Princess Leia Hoth, and an Imperial Commander. That is quite a beautiful lineup for a set. And obviously, the most famous ones, you do have the three-pack. I'm sure you remember the villain set, which came out from Sears. The villain set, of course, what a set that is. Darth Vader in the middle, flanked one side by the Stormtrooper and the other side by the Death Squad Commander. And not only that, when Empire Strikes Back came out, obviously you had the second run of the three packs from Sears. And then we got some six packs in there. First of these boxes was available just after the release of three packs. And that consisted of Darth Vader, a Hoth Stormtrooper, R2-D2, Han Hoth, C-3PO, and the Hoth Rebel Soldier. Beautiful set. And then just after that, another six pack came out. Again, with Darth Vader, with the Hoth Trooper again. The Hoth Rebel Soldier was in there, this time with an AT-AT driver, IG-88. And Yoda. And as we carry on, Jez, I mean, there's lots. You've got the Return of the Jedi 2 packs, which were the overstocked figures in those big bubbles that are often damaged, the back of the cards blank. These were packed up to basically get rid of the figures at the end of the line. Now, I can't take you through all the two packs. There's so many different combinations, but I know Darth Vader features in them. I know that out there is a beautiful example of Darth Vader and Princess Leia. What a beautiful idea for a two pack. Sure, there is plenty of other examples. Maybe we could see how many examples we can find for the release of this show, and we put it out onto We Are Generation Skywalker Facebook page. So that is probably the most common two packs and three packs that you see, but there is other ones. I mean, you've probably seen the white boxes. There's quite a few with Vader in, but you have got the four pack, which included Princess Leia Organa, Luke Skywalker, Darth Vader, and Han Solo, all original 12 figures. Quite a nice box. It's just plain white, to be fair, with written on the front, it's got the SKU number at the top, Star Wars action figure, four pack original, then another number, then the names. These boxes now, I mean, they go for a pretty penny. They're not cheap. There's plenty of different examples of these type of things out there. Yeah, the boxes are a little bit boring. They are just plain white and black. Talking of white boxes with black writing, one of the, I say common, but for a mailer, it's a slightly different. Now, the Darth Vader figure was one of several toy items available to Dutch consumers as part of Clipper's extensive Return of the Jedi mail away program. You may have seen the wraparound sticker on Clipper items, which was the offer, and then there would be a bigger, whiter sticker on the back of the mint on cards. Others that included in the offer was Akbar when he was new, 9-9. arm. I think there was a Vader carry case, bandolier strap, lots of different things in that offer. But this Darth Vader was also one of them. The figure inside this white box came in a heat steel bag, and it bared no logo. I mean, sometimes you get these mailers, they've got Kenner written on them, and then there's different baggies. But this had no logo whatsoever. It was a little hard to see through the baggie, and its cape always seemed to have a very slightly different texture than most other Vader figures. That's how you can tell what the clipper is. And the box was just plain white, like I said, black writing, so in big writing letters, Star Wars, Darth Vader, and then you've got some foreign wording, and at the bottom, Clipper Benelux Amsterdam/Brussels. So that was that. You've probably seen them around. They're quite I say they're quite common. I don't think they are quite common. I think they're quite hard to come by these days, but that is Star Wars Vintage Collection in a whole. And that leads me on to just a handful of different things. Now, let's go over to Sears again. I mean, we've already had the normal three packs, but several of the large department stores of Sears offered figures in multi-packs through their catalogue or as part of cardboard playsets. This particular set came with Vader, two Stormtroopers. It had a little booklet with it, and it came in like a plain brown cardboard mailer. Now, there's one on the SWCA, which is marked with a Sears surplus store price tag, showing that it was $4.88 and it had now a new price of $2.39. That box is going to set you back a whole lot more than that. So for anybody that picked that up at $2.39 and still has it, has done an exceptional job. Go to the 1978 Sears Wish Book. You will see that set advertised alongside three other packs of three packs. One Darth Vader, Death Squad Commander Han Solo. One of them was Chewbacca R2-D2 and C-3PO. And the other one was Jawa with two sand people. All make sense, don't they? They are three packs that make sense, and none more so than this one, Darth Vader with the two Stormtroopers. And then came around Empire Strikes Back, Sears. Again, they did a multi-pack for their department stores, a four-figure catalogue mailer pack. I love this. The box is white again, but this time we have some blue line art, and they are depicting the figures. So you've got like this blue lined box. It's got the Kenner logo in the bottom, Star Wars, the Empire Strikes Back logo bang up the top. You've then got a number to the left, ages 4 and up to the right, and at the bottom you do have a load of jargon, the addresses and whatnot, but it does say Sears number 49-59054 Star Destroyer 4-pack, and then you've got these four line art images of figures. What a pack this is. Darth Vader in a brilliant pose in his line art alongside Bosk, Boba Fett and IG-88. This was from 1980. That is a hell of a bit of packaging, and it's my understanding that this is such a rare piece to find. Extremely cool, extremely rare, but it's probably one of the most coolest multi-pack boxes or mailer boxes I have seen. Well worth going over to the Enhance for that just to see the image of this, because it is stunning. So I'm not going to go on too much more, but there are two other pieces that I did want to bring up. Canadian Sears also did an exclusive 7-pack of figures. Now, these boxes were sold in retail stores with 7 carded figures inside of them. Where the piece becomes really interesting is when it is considered that each of these packs included one of the famous shrinked wrapped figures, which were distributed exclusively by Sears Canada in the early 80s. Anybody that's not sure on the shrink wrap, go and have a Google. General Veers is the most famous example, but these were incredible figures. They were just on a plain back card, and they were shrink wrap plastic, completely different looking card, but these 7 packs had one in. Now, these 7 packs were advertised in the Sears catalogue, $21.99 for a 7-pack, and one of them did include Vader, a really nice set actually, Darth Vader, Princess Leia Organa, so in the white gown, Stormtrooper, Death Squad Commander, Luke Skywalker X-Wing Pilot, so you need this set in your Focus Jez, and then it also had Han Hoth and an Ugnaught. But there was another 4 sets of these. One of them had Luke Skywalker in his farm boy outfit, but that came with Boba Fett, Lobot, Lando, IG-88, Han Solo, and a Bespin guard, so a bit of a different mix. And you also even got a 7-pack which had Greedo, Snaggletooth, Hammerhead, Ben Kenobi, Jawa, Tusken Raider. I mean, that's another great set. But the Vader set, how beautiful would that have been in one of these boxes? These boxes were long. They had the Canadian, the French Canadian, you know, the Ligueur des Etoiles, I think that's how you say it, with the Empire logo in French in the middle, and then this long box, which you'd be able to see the cards in the front of the box. Not many examples of that around either. Very rare as well. So if you've got one of those, you're a lucky duck. And the final thing I wanted to bring up with the multi-packs is the German Power of the Force 3-pack. Now, these German Power of the Force 3-packs are some of the few foreign items to bear the Power of the Force logo, obviously, in Europe.
Europe. We had Trilogo during that period, and you didn't see much of Power of the Force over here. The carded figures bundled inside the outer packaging are standard Trilogo carded figures, so that just shows you that the Power of the Force hadn't really come across there, but this outer packaging was what it was, and it's the logo, really. So they've got the Star Wars in the shape of Power of the Force in the top left, and then it has got the German for Power of the Force, where Power of the Force would used to be written. A great big yellow band going across the front of the card. Three Star Wars action figurine, which is, I probably nailed that, being fluent in German, but, and then underneath that, Zum Sondergerangebot. So I have no idea what that says, but then it's got the beautiful Parker sign. There is some stunning vintage Star Wars stuff with Parker written on them. And then there's various packs, but I will say the one with Vader, what a three pack combination. Darth Vader, Luke Skywalker original, Han Solo original. Does it get any better than that? If I was one of those three focus collectors, you would go hard for one of these. And I mean hard in trying to find the one. Back of the card's quite interesting. It omits some of the 93 figures. And in the upper right-hand image of some of the figures, and they're missing some key accessories, you've got Leia Endor there without her poncho on. And Tebow has just, he's just wearing his stuff completely wrong. Wicket's naked. It's a very, very strange image, considering it's so far in the line. But these are my standout mailer pieces for Vader, standout multi-pack stuff for Vader. There is other stuff out there if people do want to share their multi-packs and other things I have missed, or even their two-pack combinations. Head over to We Are Generation Skywalker on Facebook, and hopefully you can start a thread over there, Jez, and put those on there.
Good work, Commander. Leave us. Conduct your search and bring his companions to me.
Yes, my lord.
Brilliant stuff. Cheers, dude. Now, I can't wait. Let's get back to Bill to find out all about his collection with the second of our interviews.
We would be honored if you would join us.
So going on to collecting then, I'd like you just to go through some of your items, and we can start off, if you may, as you've already sort of alluded to, the pre-production items. If you wouldn't mind, just talk me through what you have and if there's any particular sort of collecting stories which go with your pre-production run.
I think I got into collecting the pre-production stuff so heavily was because at the time, I guess my sort of my direction that I was taking my collection was I didn't want the stuff that everybody could get or that was easy to find. I wanted a challenge. And that was just a natural segue into collecting, like, you know, like getting into the double telescoping sabers, pre-production, things like that. And that was stuff. I mean, it really got me excited the most, you know, because I still collected production items, you know, here and there, but, yeah, it was just such a challenge. And, you know, obviously, fortunately at the time, I've been doing it so long, the stuff was, you know, wasn't too crazy expensive, but it was almost like a sort of this childhood thing. It's like, you know, you have a toy and you kind of don't want anybody else to have the toy. You want to be like the cool dude or something like that. So I don't know if it's that or just, I think the challenge of really trying to, you know, find those items that were truly historically significant or truly rare. And I think that was what kind of motivated me the most as far as going out my you know, direction of the, I was taking, like I said, taking the collection. And I don't know. It's like, I think my favorite story or favorite item, it was an item that actually took me 17 years to get. So yeah. And if you're listening to that and you haven't been collecting very long, I did say 17. Short of two decades, it took to find. It was a very, very early internal Kenner 4-inch prototype that came out, and it's called a mushroom tip saber. And these were all early in-house stuff at Kenner. It was stuff that was pretty much put together by hand. And, you know, at the time, these early prototypes, even then, back in the day, were just, they never came up for sale. Or when they did, they were like these earth-shattering finds or groups that showed up through, like, you know, dealers like the Earth, or, you know, Tom Derby would find stuff. And it was just, but still, there were certain things that just, you know, 20 years ago, you just never really, you know, you just didn't see very much. So anyway, this thing sold through Toy Shop, and unfortunately I missed the auction. There was a problem with the call in, so I was kind of upset about that. and just traced it over the years until I figured out who had it. And I reached out and I said, hey, you know, it's super excited about this piece. If you ever want to let it go, please let me know. You know, I'll do anything I have to do to get this thing. And so, yeah, so the guy finally, he honored our agreement and let me know one day and said, hey, man, I'm gonna let this thing go. We agreed on a price. And it involved, I had to fly from D.C. to Los Angeles to go pick it up. And met, hung out for about half an hour, turned around, went right back through security and got on the plane and flew home. So, brilliant. Yeah. So 17 years and a round trip that I flied across the country to get this thing. So, but it was worth it. Still, it's one of my favorite pieces. So it was well worth it.
Oh man, that's awesome. So the mushroom tip. So that's the very, correct me if I'm wrong. So that's the very earliest DT, which had the tiny little sort of mushroom end to it, which would assist with the pulling out of the arm. Is that correct?
Yeah, it was. I think it was the first iteration of the double telescoping saber. When you see the design, it's the mechanics of it. It's pretty obvious why that wasn't progressed. The mushroom tip is actually it's a little bit different, but it had to be applied by hand. And then of course you have just the mechanics of it. You have to insert the saber, put the tip on. You know, it's basically three pieces. So yeah, it wasn't hard to figure out why that didn't go, because that's like, well, that's not in the design for mass production. But the figure, everything else, they came from very early molds that are specific to that figure. So there's details on it that absolutely they don't match up to the production figure, which I think actually makes it a little bit more cool. So yeah. Yes.
So that's not even your sort of regular, he says, your regular first shot Vader. So it's different to that. It's different to the production Vader as well as the saber.
Yeah. The saber and the figure are, there's significant differences between that and the production.
Well, no wonder you stayed firm, and 17 years later, you got exactly what you're after. I probably wouldn't have wanted to do anything after that trip as well. I would have not wanted to have left the airport. It would have been, no, I'm going straight home.
Well, I think it's kind of funny. It's like, that's, I guess, maybe one of my collecting superstitions is like, you know, I really don't talk about stuff until I have it like literally in hand, or, you know, the deal's done and I'm back home and it's safe in the Vader vault. So, but yeah, it was crazy because that piece, like I said, obviously it was something that was super huge to me as far as a collecting goal. It was like, you know, absolutely one of the grails that I had. And then over the years, I've just been super fortunate. Like I found the original art for the original photo art for that, where the figure was actually used. And then I found out through some of our French friends that it's actually the same figure that was used for a lot of their photography from Marcano. So it's just like, I was able to go back through and really dig up a lot of the history on the figure. And it's just, I don't know. That's probably one of the ones I'd never saw.
Oh, I understand. That's brilliant. What is available when we go back to the sort of original wax sculpts and everything else? Are these things available? Are they in your collection?
Well, there is one sculpt that I'm aware of that is unfortunately not in my collection, which I'd definitely love to have. Hard copies, I have actually never seen a 4-inch Vader hard copy or even a piece, which I always thought was odd. So I don't know. Somebody's got those on lockdown and they've been hiding them for 30 years, but hard copy stage. The only one that I have seen is the one I own, and that's the one from Top Toys. So, from the original 4-inch Vader, I've never even seen so much as a maybe even like a part of. Definitely, like I have a 15-inch hard copy. So they definitely exist, but now the super, super early stuff, really don't see that very often. As far as first shots, I don't think. It's almost like a stage that I think was, I don't know if it was skipped, but I am not actually aware of any first shots outside of the internal first shots, like the super early ones. And of those, there's four of those in different iterations. And fortunately, I actually own two of those.
Impressive. Most impressive.
2D items, one proof card or a range of proof cards, which always leap out to my mind. And that's the Power of the Force concept mock-ups. They almost look like they were made in a school. I believe I've seen those in your collection. Is that right? Have you got the Power of the Force concept mock-ups?
Oh, they, I think they were the Revenge of the Jedi.
And right. Yes, that's right. Yeah.
So they're definitely trying out different logos. And at one point, let me see. I think if you go, it's actually funny. If you go through the Tomart Worldwide Guide to, you know, the sort of the OG collecting book, and the one in a slipcase, there's actually a whole section, a supplement section in it with nothing but prototypes. And I think there's one page, it's like the whole page is list out the majority of those. And I think, yeah, I think at one time I had 10 of those.
Right.
But yeah, the Vaders, actually, I ended up selling those to a really good Vader friend. Those went to go fund a nice prop purchase. So, right. Yeah, those, I think that's probably fair to say that's one of those things I'm kind of like, kind of wish I would have held those up. But, you know, it's, you can't have everything.
Absolutely.
And
not,
they went to a good home. So that's, you know, it's all good.
Sometimes we have to push things on to fund something big. As you say, you just got it for a prop piece. So good for you. Props to you. I like the fact that that particular piece, or those pieces rather, it was just one of those combinations of quite clearly licensed Kenner product, but then it was just hand drawn on, wasn't it? It was just, it looked like something which would happen in a junior school or something or other. I remember it was Mark Carraway had the Luke X-Wing once, and he showed me a photograph, and it just blew my mind. Fantastic stuff. Large size action figures. You've already mentioned the 15-inch, you know, that which as part of the 12-inch line, clearly Vader's a bit of a big chap. Now there's various different things going on there. We've got the regular ones, the Canadian ones. Would you mind telling me what was the deal with the Empire Strikes Back? Was that specific to Australia?
So basically, in America, by the time that the line was coming around for the Empire refresh, we all know basically the sales weren't there, so they decided to close it. So there is anecdotal evidence that maybe there was like a test market area where a couple, like I think it was Chewbacca for the most part, was actually released in the Empire box. But as far as the Australian releases go, they're actually very specific to Australia. They have actually, the printing on the box is different. So if you look at the details on the box and you actually hold them up side by side, there is a significant difference between, you know, the Toll Toys, the Australian version, and, you know, all the other releases. Sort of like the Canadian release had all the heights were done in metric, in centimeters. So, you know, they didn't use imperial measurements, things like that. The Australian version actually completely omitted the height measurement. There's no imperial or metric measurements on there. Mm-hmm. So when you look at it, it just says, you know, posable action figure. So it's actually, they're really, really interesting pieces, you know, once you start getting into it. And a lot of people, like, I'm not sure a lot of people realize, but there is actually a Star Wars Toll Toys release for Australia that is specific to Australia. So you just have to know what the box looks like. But yeah, it's the Empire release, even on Australia, is super like crazy rare. I think I've only seen maybe three or four, you know, and that included mine. So yeah, they are insanely rare.
And then sticking with that line then, because before I jump onto another which caught my eye, is it the Bassa? 12-inch, what? Bassa 15-inch Vader, but it's not quite 15-inch, is it? Is the Vader smaller for the Bassa one?
He is, actually. Yeah, it's based off, obviously, the mold, and it's, I would love to figure that out, actually. I've always been interested with that, because it's not a one-to-one, you know, off the actual, you know, figure itself, because the figure is smaller, and there are sculpting, you know, there's definitely some differences in the figure itself. So yeah, it's a little bit smaller.
Right. And it was the other one which caught my eye was the Leddy. Now, you know, people talk about, you know, the hard to find Leddy figures, and I understand that the Leddy one is quite hard to find as well. Is that right?
Oh yeah, he's another one. I've definitely seen a few more examples floating around, but you know, honestly, I'd say probably the last 10 years, I really haven't seen very much activity as far as, you know, box examples. they're just, yeah, they are super, super tough to find.
Is there any particular large size action figure which you don't have at the moment or is on your radar that you would disclose?
Oh, yeah, actually a boxed box of Vader.
Right, okay.
Yeah. I have probably like four or five loose ones, but yeah, don't have a box one. I'd love to add one.
Yeah, I bet. Right, okay. All right, listeners, get amongst it. Box 12-inch Bass of Vader, please. That would be great. Now, moving away from that, only so slightly, because there's one range which I think is absolutely brilliant, and that's the 8-inch. And Vader came under the 8-inch line as well, didn't he?
The vintage, yeah. There was a Takara
figure,
and they came carded. That was a vintage equivalent. There are a few modern ones, but yeah, I absolutely love that figure. I have to say, I mean, of all the stuff, especially all the vintage stuff and even some of the newer stuff, I think a lot of the Japanese products are just so, so good.
Yeah, absolutely. I think R2-D2 collectors have lucked in there, haven't they? Because I know that the Japanese have done a great deal of the R2. But yeah, definitely it does seem that Vader did come a close second to what the Japanese market were fulfilling.
Oh, yeah.
So, Bill, I'm going to share with you now an item which I've seen online on the Star Wars Collector's Archive. Mock-up inflatable lightsaber. Mate, that needs to be in your collection if it's not already, if this thing still exists. So this is a confidential internal Kenner photo. Shows what is almost certainly the first three-dimensional representation of inflatable lightsaber. So actually, it's a photograph. So, yeah. I got a bit excited then. You could probably tell in my voice I was getting a bit carried away.
Oh, wow. That is cool. Yeah. Yeah, that is really cool.
That's just something different.
Yeah, that's nuts. Yeah, it's funny because it's like if you look at the hilt, it's almost, you can tell it's pretty much inspired by the actual art.
Yeah.
Like the McQuarrie art. Like if you look at the McQuarrie art, the way he depicted the sabers, yeah, that's kind of what it looks like.
Nice.
Yeah, that's nuts. Yeah.
That is not
part of my collection, and definitely would not turn it down either. So that's really cool.
I love looking at the archive. It was only, I don't know, a year or so ago, I saw the squirt gun. I think it was the Han Solo squirt gun. So, you know, the pistols, which, you know, Luke and Han did, and they did of Star Wars and Empire and Jedi, you know, box pistols. They had one of those hollowed out like a squirt gun. That would have been brilliant. That would have been so good.
That would have been cool.
I think it's the other nuts thing which I saw was the Darth Vader utility belt. You know, the one which comes with the belt and it randomly comes with a pistol as well. Have you seen
one? Yeah.
Yeah. Yep. My assumption is you have one of those in your collection.
Well, the interesting thing about those is there's actually two variants of that.
All right.
Yeah, the first one that came out is, if you look at different pictures, a lot of people will miss this, but if you look at the insert itself of the box, there's a vacuum form, like a plastic tray, white plastic tray version, and then the other one is actually just like a standard, like a reddish sort of a cardboard insert. The contents are the same, but it's the insert is kind of what makes it different. But yes, I have actually had both of those.
Wow.
Yeah, I love those. Those are weird and quirky.
Yeah, they really are cool. I mean, Vader having a pistol. Well, I guess he did when he sort of force pulled hands out of his on Bespin, so it could be that one. But I recognize that I just spoke about a couple of items and said I assume you've got that in your collection, and I've just sort of checked myself because you've got 70,000 pieces in your collection, so we're not going to do that for the rest of the night, because I think the likelihood is you'll say, yeah, I got that.
There's definitely certain things that, like, you would ask, you said something about the vehicles and things like that. It's like, I don't actually own a Star Destroyer.
Right.
It's one of those things that, kind of going back to what I said before, it's like a lot of my hard and fast rule is like, there's things that, you know, if I like it, I collect it. And kind of going back to my childhood, it was like one of those things that I just never had. And so I just never, I think, got emotionally invested in it. So kind of going forward, it was one of those things like, I mean, it's cool, but it's not really like Vader specific enough cool. It's like a playset. And I think that's the way my brain kind of filtered it. It's like, well, it's kind of like this generic playset, you know, not really getting a huge Vader vibe out of it. But yeah, really, I don't have an extensive collection as far as a lot of the vehicles, especially like the TIE fighters go. You know, some of our friends that are Vader collectors as well. I mean, some of the guys have, I think they've almost put together complete runs of all the different packaging, which, I mean, they look amazing. You know, they're super cool, but it's just not really my thing.
No, I understand that. I understand that entirely with regards to the Star Destroyer. But also, as you said earlier on, space, isn't it? It's, well, not space in the galaxy far, far away, but physical space in your collection rooms and within your property to have these, you know, taking up a lot of space already, aren't they?
Oh, it's, yeah, it's, you know, space is, it's such a premium because, you know, when you start thinking about the practical side of it, like one of the guys that asked about the lighting, like here's a good example, sort of a mental exercise, is how do you display or how do you curate your 2D items? And I don't necessarily mean the easy stuff, like the proof cards. Like there's a lot of people that have, you know, like I have a Kremlin proof for a Darth Vader Empire Strikes Back case. I mean, the thing's like the size of a movie poster. So it's like, you know, the bigger stuff is like super challenging, especially for 2D, because you can't, you know, it's insane to even think that you could display it all. So there's things like I use a map cabinet or sort of like a blueprint cabinet, just, you know, common office thing.
Yeah.
And it's, you're allowed to store a lot of stuff, but it's like, you know, yeah, it's the thing's huge. You know, it's the floor footprint of a movie poster, but it's like 4 feet high. So it's like, you know, it's bigger than most people's refrigerators. Yeah, it's definitely challenging. I mean, you know, I think what I do is it's sort of a distillation process as far as what I want to display. The things that are super important to me, or the things that I just personally enjoy seeing on a daily basis, are usually the items that I'm going to put out. So, you know, and it can be an eclectic range of stuff for sure. I mean, I have original movie props on display and, you know, a $2 Burger King toy. So, you know, space is a premium.
Now, talking of something which shouldn't take up too much space, before we go on to the sort of film memorabilia, cast and crew, etc., bootlegs, be it Uzai or Polish. How do bootlegs fit into your collection, or do they?
That's a good question. I think generationally for me, when the bootlegs really started hitting the market, I mean, I was there, believe it or not, when the first Uze started coming out, and it was just, I mean, stuff that was so accessible and cheap that, you know, I just picked it up more as a curiosity type of a thing. And definitely over the years, over the decades, it's the kind of thing that, for me, and as far as my collecting aesthetic, I don't really think was necessarily a good fit. And plus that, when I started evaluating the cost and I saw the values of stuff, it was just something I didn't really want to pursue. You know, I love the items. I think they're super cool. Like I said, I mean, you can tell a lot of the quirky sort of oddball stuff are the things that I really like. And I mean, bootlegs definitely fit that purpose. You know, they're definitely, you know, they can be quirky and a little odd at times. But yeah, it wasn't something I think that I just could really entertain as far as time and you know, finances. I think I picked up, well, arguably, I still think I had one of the nicest men on card Uze Vaders, and I think I paid like a whopping $200 for it at the time. So,
blimey. You know. Wow. Oh, good for you. Moving on to, yeah. I know that you're a huge film fan, and that's the part of it, you know. What do we have then? If you were to curate me around your sort of presentation room, around the Vader Vault, if you were to say, right, okay, we've got a few minutes, I must show you this, or I must talk to you about this, let's do it. Let's imagine I'm there. What have you got to show me?
I think the first thing I would show you is actually, it's still my grail piece. I'll probably get buried with it, is one of the helmets from A New Hope that was production made. It just was never finished. So that, it was just like the grail of grails for me, is to be able to get any prop from A New Hope of Vader. Like, I didn't care what it was. If it was like a scrap of some black fabric that somebody found in a garbage can and said, oh yeah, yeah, it's like one of the guys that, one of the costume guys saved this for 30 years, I would still, I'd be over the moon with something like that. So yeah, I never, never in a million years, even in my wildest expectations, could even reasonably think or assume that I'd ever own something like that. So that's definitely one of the highlights. I was able to, fortunately, I was able to pick up what still exists from the George Lucas Super Live Adventure that was done by Kenneth Fell Productions in Japan. But through whatever reason, I was able to pick up the helmet from that, and a little bit was left over of the costume. So,
right.
Yeah, those things are, I mean, I think those are the things that I really like the most. You know, it just represents sort of that tangible connection to the history of something I basically grew up, I've been in love with my whole life. And just to be able to hold an actual piece of that history, you know, in my hands, and just to have the opportunity to have that in my collection is, you know, to me, that's kind of like why I started collecting in the first place. It's one of the things that ticks all the boxes, man. I just love it.
It epitomizes everything, doesn't it? I mean, you say you can hold it in your hands, but I guess that just holds an audience. As soon as you walk in and see that, I would just stop still and just look at it in wonder, I'm sure. Yeah, it's, I can completely get why that's a standout piece for you. Absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, I think it's this that, you know, like when you go to a museum, and you know, if you're historically inclined or you understand the history about the things that you're looking at, or you know, for me, for example, for the industry I'm in, that, you know, I can go to like an air and space museum and see the actual thing that I'm intimately familiar with historically is just you can't really describe it. It's just surreal to, you know, to be that close to something. And I think I have that same sentiment when it comes to the collecting side. There are things that I just, you know, you have such a strong connection to, and then it's somebody comes in and is like, hey man, this is the actual thing, it's yours. And it's, yeah, just surreal to me.
Yeah, completely. You go into an air and space museum in the UK, you know, we've got American hangars with SR-71s and everything, and it's just, you have that sort of library moment where everyone's just quiet, respecting it and just wandering around and seeing history from various World War One, Two, and everything else. And this is the equivalent from our galaxy far, far away. Wonderful.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And sort of backdrop to that then, I understand you've got storyboards and various different bits building that movie magic as well, yeah?
Oh yeah, yeah. I absolutely love I should say there probably is very little that within the context of Vader that is not like cast, crew, you know, storyboards, things like that, that I don't absolutely love. I picked up quite a few you know, storyboards. I've been incredibly lucky to actually own some originals. I love all that stuff. Like I said, it's just, to me, it is the literal expression of, you know, being able to hold history in your hands. And that's just, to me, is just like the pinnacle of, that's like the zenith of my collecting sort of experience, is just to be able to hold that.
Yeah. No, I completely get it. I'm in there now. I can visualize it. I've seen the videos that you've shared, or all the sort of TV documentaries, and yeah, wonderful. I know that there's so much passion and joy in this. You know, you walk into the vault and you still get that buzz. Yeah.
Oh, I mean, absolutely. There's some things that are just so incredibly special that, you know, I definitely like some of the original art I own. You know, I've been super fortunate to be able to own pieces from some of my favorite artists. And there isn't a time, like, you know, I'm sitting here right now and it's like, you know, I look at this piece hanging up and I'm like, I love that today at this moment as much as the day that I picked it up and I bought it and I brought it home. you know, there's like a good example is my friend Bruce White. And what Bruce is known for is creating portraits on, you know, black velvet.
Yeah.
And of course, like in America, that's like a cliche thing. It always was. It was like, oh yeah, these velvet paintings of Elvis. And, but he has refined it and used the medium, and the stuff he does is insane. Like the Vader piece he did for me is still like, it blew me away when I saw it. And it's still one of those things. It's like, you know, people walk in, they just immediately gravitate towards it. And it's just one of those things that makes you happy. Or like, I have an original Mark Ratz, Darth Vader that we had talked about as a commission, you know, and I obviously Mark is just like this crazy, stupid genius artist. You know, I think he's done everything for Lucasfilm, but I talked to him. I was like, man, I'd really like to get something, but this is like when Rogue One was coming out. And, I said, man, I'd love to get something sort of like an idealized, like a New Hope Vader, but something freshened up for Rogue One. And he did this piece for me, and I just like almost got, you know, I got tears in my eyes. I just couldn't believe that this guy did this for me. It's like, it was so insanely good and just off the chart for anything I had even hoped for. You know, yeah, that's an own. Like some guy, I think, actually got that as a tattoo. But yeah, it's just like, you know, I think in a larger sense, I mean, maybe that's a good point to make is there's one thing I wish I would see from some of the newer collectors is just, I think, a level of that kind of passion for things, because I think people become too myopic about, you know, oh, like I just got to get this deal. I got to find this stuff and I got to make a score. And I got to do this and do that. And you know, the one thing is devoid of this process or what I see now is there's just not a lot of like super crazy passion for stuff. I mean, and that's a generalization. So, you know, there's absolutely, you know, like just today I was reading something that somebody had posted and they found this thing that they had been looking for, you know, for 20 years. And it's like, you know, super stoked for them. And that's awesome. And that's the way it should be. You know, there's stuff that if it isn't giving you a level of pleasure or enjoyment, then you're just in the wrong business or you're in the wrong hobby, you know? And it's like, I've been doing this a long time. And there's stuff that I absolutely just still to this day, I love. Absolutely. And it's, yeah. So I guess that would be my collecting takeaway for a lot of this is, you know, just collect what you love, honestly. You know, whatever makes you happy, don't collect what, you know, five other people tell you that you should be collecting or makes them happy. It doesn't matter what it is. I mean, hell, man, I got laughed at when I started. Guys, they thought I was crazy. They laughed or kind of blew me off thinking, oh, man, well, you only want to collect one thing. Now it's like a common hobby practice.
Yeah.
So, you know.
You were like the OG focus collector, weren't you? You were one of the very first focus collectors. Yeah, I can.
Yeah, I think there was probably like three or four of us, or maybe like five guys. Like there was John Wooten and a couple guys did like Jawa. John Kellerman did Leia. So yeah, I mean there were definitely guys. You know, definitely guys doing the single focus thing. I think I was maybe the one that was maybe more vocal about it or more kind of aggressive about just collecting one thing.
Now I listened to your episode on the Kivecast. Just this week, I listened to that again, went back to that. And Sky asks you the question, what about your Holy Grail? To which, at that stage, you didn't answer it because I think you kind of alluded to it earlier on. Keep your cards close to your chest until the deal is done. But the Holy Grail, which you had in your mind back in, I think that was 2011, that episode, has that actually come into your... Is this the piece which took 17 years or is there something else which you're able to share with us?
I think at the time, yeah, I'd have to go back and look at that and kind of calibrate the timeline there. But I think in 2011, it definitely would have been, I think it was an obtuse idea, like I said, about being able to find any sort of a New Hope era Vader prop. Or I mean, honestly, anything from the OT, if it was an OT Vader prop, I wanted it. It didn't matter what it was from. So at the time is probably what I was alluding to. I don't think it was necessarily anything specific. There's like, even now there's stuff that I've I got in the pipeline now that, you know, until it's like physically sitting in my hands, I still don't, you know, I won't talk about it until it's there.
Sure.
But yeah, I think externally with, when it comes to discussing your grails, I mean, collecting is competitive, you know, I mean, let's be honest about it. It's very competitive. And I think once you've made a little bit of a name for yourself or some notoriety, you know, for the stuff you do, I think advertising it is definitely going to cause you competition. Absolutely. You know, okay. There's things that will come up and be like, oh man, hey, you know, Bob is like a huge R2-D2 collector. You know, he's been doing this, you know, same thing, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, oh, he's going super hard for this one piece. And it's like, well, obviously, if he's doing that, then that's going to attract attention. So, yeah, that's definitely like, as far as my more secret stuff, yeah, I usually keep that to myself.
Sure. Now I'm going to go completely off track now then. So moving away from grails, moving away from this, that, and the other. As I close now, there was one thing which I saw, which was Darth Vader Coca-Cola. Now, I believe that that was a custom, possibly maybe Bill Cable or someone like that. Swag, you know, it's becoming more and more popular nowadays, or customs. What's your favorite piece of Vader swag or custom? And what is the story behind that Darth Vader Coke?
Well, okay, so the Darth Vader Coke, actually, that was a gift from Martin Thurn. He's the president of the Washington, D.C. area Collectors Club. And he had these things made up, and he handed them over, and I'm just like, wow, that's really cool. That's a really good question. What is my favorite bit of Vader swag? I mean, that's a good question. I got to think about that for a minute. I mean, I have seen, I will say across the board, the swag collecting game, and as far as what I see people making for Celebration and some of these other shows, is just insane. I mean, people are so creative and so talented. It's almost like, it's like, man, I don't even know what I would do to keep up with some of the stuff I've seen. It's so good. Okay, so I got it. I just figured it out. So my favorite Vader swag is, they're actually party favors from Ralph McQuarrie's birthday. And for the birthday celebration, what is these little things they made up for all the guests that were invited, these little tiny, they kind of look like the palm talkers. They're like 2.5-3 inches tall. They were actually fast food toys. They're like, I think they were like Burger King or something. And they made these things up, and it's like, they put little party hats on them. And on the bottom, it says, you know, Ralph McQuarrie's birthday, blah, blah, blah. And so there were two different events. There was one for his birthday and another for like another celebration he had. And I was able to get both of those. And those are probably my favorite, because I think, obviously, the Ralph McQuarrie, you know, connection.
Yeah.
And then just, you know, a friend of mine through collecting, he knew I'd really appreciate it. So he actually gave those to me. Those are probably my two favorite Vader swag items.
Outstanding. Bill, thank you so much for giving up so much of your time tonight. To go through your collection and to share some of your stories with us. I really, really appreciate it. Before I let you go, Star Wars Celebration in London next year. Any chance you're coming over to Europe soon?
I would very much like to. I am, I guess, in the enviable position of, I just actually got a promotion to an engineering position on my program. So it's going to consume a lot of my time, so it's just been super challenging to kind of make those plans. But if at all possible, yes, absolutely.
Well, we would absolutely love to see you over here next year if that's possible. But congratulations on the promotion, and yeah, we'll just watch that space. But mate, thank you so much. It's been absolutely brilliant. I've loved speaking with you this evening, Bill McBride, Guinness World Record holder, the Don of Darth Vader. Thank you so much. You are Generation Skywalker.
Oh, thank you.
Great shot, kid. That was one in a million.
Remember, the Force will be with you always.
Wow. wonderful stuff, and we'll hear a little bit more from Bill later on with a rapid fire round. Dan, as you know, Bill's spoken about the 12-inch Vader or the 15-inch Vader from the 12-inch line. Didn't you buy one recently at auction?
Yeah, I've not been into the 12-inch figures or the large size action figures at all. I've always shied away from them. But I think, you know, when you start to run out of things to buy, you start to look for other options. And I've just on eBay and came across one that wasn't, it was particularly poorly listed, but it didn't seem to get much interest. But it was in a really nice Denny's Fisher box. Got it for a great price. And I think with this Vader figure, I think the sculpt of it's a little bit undervalued. I don't, you know, when you think of, you know, 12-inch figures in 1977. You don't think the quality of this is, the sculpt is absolutely amazing. I'd say the mask they've sculpted back then is possibly one of the best I've seen. It's really good. I think the only thing that really lets it down is the cape. He's got a nice little bow. Looks like he's wearing a bow tie on the front. But other than that, it's a beautiful figure and the box as well. Yeah, the Denny's Fisher one was one Bill, I don't think he mentioned in the interview, but it's the subsidiary of Palatoy. Did a bit of digging into this. I think it's probably been covered a number of times by other individuals more educated than me, but I think the Leia and the Luke both came in Palatoy boxes for the most part. They took on the manufacturing of those. And Denny's Fisher, who was, like I say, a subsidiary of Palatoy. Palatoy obviously too busy, you know, distributing all of the 3¾-inch, sub that out to Denny's Fisher. And yeah, they produced the UK line of the 12-inch figures. And yeah, Vader was one of them. So yeah, lovely figure and a nice company logo, Denny's Fisher. I didn't have it in my collection before.
Is it sealed, mate?
No, hasn't got the insert either. Need an insert. It's the same picture on the card back. Have you used the same image off the Kenner card or the Palatoy card back, Kenner card back, 3¾-inch card back? So they've still got that. They're using that same image. It's got the racetrack around the window of where the character, you can see the figure inside, and underneath that an image of Vader. It's the same image used on the Darth Vader's TIE Fighter, where they've got that Darth Vader looking to a profile there. But yeah, it's got the little pill box like you get on the carded figures with his name on. Nice variation of the layout for the vintage card backs.
Nice. Cheers, mate. No, I remember when you got that, and yeah, you were well chuffed. So yeah, nice addition. Yeah,
I would like one of those. If anyone spots one of those Empire Strikes Back Australian Darth Vaders, I'd I'd quite like one of those.
There's probably a queue with that, isn't there?
Yeah, it's very nice. I think the other thing that was nice about Bill's interview was, I think he said that he was the Darth Vader's Death Star, oh, not Death Star, Star Destroyer. It was an item he didn't actually own.
Yeah.
So I've actually got something in my collection, Darth Vader related, that he hasn't got.
And he's probably got 69,995 pieces that you don't have. But yeah, I love the fact he just said, I got no connection with that one. So it's space, isn't it?
Space, and you've got to have boundaries and rules, haven't you? I like the fact when he was talking about his own collecting and that he has got rules. And, you know, when you've got a collection outside, I think you've got to, haven't you, to maintain control of, especially with a character like Vader.
You underestimate the power of the dark side.
Let's have another little look at the carded figures. I know we've jumped around a little bit, but as happens with a lot of the principal characters, you think about Luke Skywalker, you think about Han, you think about Chewbacca and Stormtroopers, you know, they change their photography on the card back, don't they, on the card art as we come through. So on the original ones, you've got Vader just looking with his red lightsaber ignited and goes all the way through. And then you start to see the card change, don't you? So it's the classic, then Vader just looking forward like we see on pictures, posters, jigsaws. So that's the Topps toys have it that way round. We move on as we get to, I think it's around about, yeah, so it's the 65D that we change, so we've got that Vader straight on. What are your thoughts on the card backs with regards to your preference, any of you?
He's actually got a purple lightsaber, not a red one, in there. Another class piece of Photoshop by Kenner.
I am not colorblind, and yeah, you're right, it is purple.
Yeah, I think I really like, I've got the Empire Strikes Back carded Vader is one of my favourite, but I really wish they'd used a scene from Empire on that card because there's so many great steals from that movie. And yeah, I think the one they used originally, I don't think it's the greatest image in the world. It's a bit blurry. I mean, it's probably half the problem with it being such a black character, just black on black. Just yeah, it's hard to set it off, isn't it? But yeah, the second image is quite iconic as well. That photo of Vader, and like you say, it's used on, I think I've got a puzzle of that image as well. It was quite widely used, that image. But I don't know if I prefer it to the original or not. I do like Vader in a fighting pose. I think I prefer that aesthetic.
From a design perspective, the second one they used is just neater. I mean, it just fills the space better. Everything sits a little bit more harmoniously. But given the choice, I think the original one is just, I don't know, it gives me the feels a little bit more because that's the one I remember from back in the day.
Yeah. It's interesting because it does appear that different countries have swapped it around a little bit more. And then actually when you look, our Troy logo as we know it stuck with the original. So our Troy logo, you know, we didn't change. We never changed, in fact. That one face on, the second one, the newer one, obviously that was Kenner Canada. That's all fine, all covered off. Yeah, so that one just didn't come to the UK from a Palatoy point of view. Yeah, Kenner Imports for sure. But what I thought was interesting, and for the Power of the Force, they revert back to the original artwork for the Power of the Force. I wonder why that was.
Yeah, I was just looking at that. It looks to be really struggling to hold up as well. I mean, they've zoomed in on a pretty fuzzy image already. They've cropped even tighter on it.
Yeah. You know, I see this. I see a lot of the changes. I see the changes they did for Han. I see the changes they did for Chewie. And it did come across to me that they were trying to make them less aggressive. They're less weapons in the changes. They're sort of less of an action pose in a lot of respects for a lot of these figures. And the Darth Vader face on, the close-up one, yeah, it certainly doesn't look as menacing necessarily. I love the Anakin sticker on it, though. There was a beta carded Darth Vader which was doing the rounds on Star Wars forum from, like, I don't know, easily from 2009 for about 5 years, and it just kept on changing hands, and I had it for a while, and it was the Anakin sticker slap bang straight over Vader's face, and I really loved it. It would be nice to know who's got that one now, but yeah, just what your opinion on the change in card art and what you thought of it.
So that card art, that was the first figure I ever bought off of SWFUK back in the day, what, 10 years ago?
Really?
I can't remember. I bought it off now. Yeah, that was my first mint on card purchase from that forum.
Nice.
And I've still got it.
You've still got it. Sweet. Yeah. And then obviously there's the Glass Elite as well, which has got its pretty much generic card with just the Darth Vader sticker on it. So yeah, a few different versions. What else was there? Who else brought out the Darth Vader? Not necessarily carded. Poppy. Or Popey. So yeah,
oh,
Empire Strikes Back one as well. One of those many ones which came out. So yeah, part of the run. Darth Vader Popey. So from a focus point of view, all sorts of stuff. Fun of the fair for everyone.
You found something.
Yes, ma'am.
That's it. The rebels are there.
So let's head back to the variant villains with Jamie and Mark, who are going to delve into the fascinating world of the foreign variants. And this is going to separate the Returno from the Regresso. To keep the world spinning, it takes all kinds of kinds. All kinds of kinds. All kinds of kinds. All kinds of kinds.
Shall we move on to some of the later figures? There's a couple of interesting variants, aren't there, including the blank raised bar?
Yeah, well, as the line went on, Kenner's policy on the COOs moved into more of a situation where they were drilling into the molds themselves to remove the COOs, which is essentially what that raised bar is, a bar of over where the Hong Kong was. So now you have a blank raised bar.
Excellent. Are you happy now to move on to the foreign variants?
Probably the transition one that we should probably talk about first is Pock. The parts from the Cader and the Unito factories in the late Empire Strikes Back era, those parts were bought by the Spanish licensee Pock. over in Spain, they took those parts, they painted them, they assembled them, and they sold them off into their market. Those figures can be quite often mixed up. It's quite a hard one to identify as well, because there's very little paint on Vader, and paint is really what the POC line is about. It's the unique paint. I mean, the parts themselves are Asian produced, but it's the paint that was applied in Spain and the assembly. So yeah, they're quite a hard figure to differentiate from the Asian ones. To the best of my understanding, POC used imported Vader capes produced from the, you know, the two likely suspects, Kader and Unitoy. Until we do a full guide, there's just no way of being 100% certain about that. But to the best of my knowledge, imported late Empire Strikes Back vinyl capes from Asia.
Shall we move on to the Takara Vader sculpt? It's one of a lot of people's favourites. Can you tell me what it is and how it differs?
The very first license to sell Star Wars toys in Japan was Takara. They had a line of three figures, which is C-3PO, the Stormtrooper, and our good old friend Darth Vader. This figure is one of the tougher ones to find. The sculpt is entirely unique. Takara lightsaber is shorter, cape is unique, and they look quite different to the regular Hong Kong produced ones. So they have that sort of allure about them, being rare, one thing, but then also looking different. When you're looking through all your Vader side by side, quite often they can look quite similar. You put the Takara in there as well,
and it just has a wow factor.
How about Lily Letty? I understand they've got a version with a Hong Kong coup.
They do. This is a very tough figure to find. It's their early Retorno release. So the molds themselves were taken from Hong Kong. They were sent across, and Lily Lady produced a very small batch of Hong Kong COO'd Darth Vader figures from the Unitoy factory. So very thin saber. The cape itself is unique. These are all unique accessories that were made in Mexico to abide by the laws at that point in time.
Okay, so this is a harder to find one, and that would, I guess, account for the price difference between that and the Regreso.
Yeah, the Regreso Vader is one of the made in Mexico figures. So this is one of the unique sculpts that Lily Liddy had that were produced at high volume and exported outside of Mexico. So it's one of the first exports that Lily Liddy did in this later era. And these figures were sent to the US market, and they can be found on 77 back cards. It's a much easier to find figure. There's still a higher value in it. You know, it is ultimately a Lily Liddy figure. Thicker saber, unique sculpt, and a blobbed COO for the made in Mexico Darth Vader.
Okay, just for clarification, you mentioned earlier that there are two variants for Lily Letty, the Retorno and the Regreso. Guessing there's two different sabers, you even touched on it there, but there's only one unique mold listed on Variant Villain. Can you just clarify?
The Regreso with the thick tip is the unique mold. So the Lily Letty Retorno has the thin tip that was... The mold was sent across from the Unitoy factory in Asia. So they produced their run of figures with a very thin tip. On the later Made in Mexico series, Lily Letty had their own mold, as I mentioned earlier, for the figure. But the same thing applies for the saber. So, yeah, you get this thicker tip version of the saber, which Lily Letty used on their regressive line.
Okay, moving on from one of the rarest, there's the PBP figure from Spain. Can you tell us a little about that one?
The PBP produced Vader, it's a bit of a two-lane highway. The first one they did has a blobbed COO. That one's a bit harder to find. It's got a unique saber to it that has more of a orangey sort of look. Now, that's the first PBP figure. The second one that they exported, I wouldn't say it's common, but it's definitely harder to find. That one there has their more traditional scarred COO, so like the deep scar. There's a number of different cape types. We call it rugose, like a leathery sort of look. And there's different sort of thicknesses of the capes. I think there's about four different versions, various degrees of thickness, essentially. The saber on the later export is a Hong Kong-produced imported accessory. So it's not one that they made in Spain.
And that's the rounded transition saber. Okay, we've got two final foreign variants, the Top Toys and the Glass Leet.
Okay, well, Glass Leet first. Brazil, similar to what we discussed last time with the R2 pop-up, much later on, in around 88, took on a handful of the Kader China molds and produced a very small run of figures, Vader being one of them. It has a unique saber, so they produce their own molds for the saber, and a unique cape. So the figure itself has a few little characteristics. It's a bit shinier. Obviously, the paint is different. There's not a lot in the actual figure itself, but you can differentiate it. Yeah, it's the accessories you're going to pay a lot of money for, particularly with that one. Lastly is the Top Toys. Top Toys is another crazy outlier, an Argentine license that produced their own limited run taken from casts of the original Kenner figures. So the Top Toys Vader, when you look at it, it's a bit smaller, very poorly produced. It has a bootleg feel to it, these figures. They're hard to find. I mean, it's from Argentina. It's a very small market. What survives nowadays is, you know, difficult to come across. The accessories are unique. The cape is unique. And the actual figure has a completely unique look about it as well.
Brilliant information. Cheers, Mark.
Any final impressions of the figure? Like, let's hear from yourself. What do you think, mate?
When you first look at Vader, when you first start collecting, you honestly look at it and you think all of them look and feel the same. Started to collect it, started to enjoy it a lot more. Realised there's just hundreds of variants. I'm so glad they're working on a cape guide because it's so easy to get these all mixed up. I just look forward to that and to sorting out my collection.
It's probably the most difficult in terms of the breadth and the knowledge required to really get a handle on all the variations for this figure. It is a beast, which is appropriate for the Dark Lord. And hopefully we've managed to make this cohesive and give you the information that you need just to sort of get the ball rolling on a bit of understanding for the Darth Vader figure. All right, guys, thanks a lot. Back to you.
Lads, thank you so much. Now I know the difference from my Takara to my Top Toys. You've brilliantly explained that, so thank you ever so much for your time. Craig, coming to you, mate. Darth Vader carry cases.
I'm sure everyone is familiar with this thing, but for those who aren't, it's a semi-3D head and shoulders bust, which is hinged at the bottom. It's got three clasps around the edge, and it's designed to hold 31 figures with a little compartment for accessories. So if you imagine 15 figures either side, that gives you an idea of the size of this thing. It also has a little handle, which is suggested by the name carry case. I mean, for me, I think it's a lovely item that never really quite worked as it should. The figures would rattle around and would invariably fall out when you opened it. But it was one of the things when I first saw it advertised, and I'll come on to that in a bit, I just had to have it. And it was always quite a desirable thing for me as a kid collecting this stuff back in the day. By all accounts, it's seemingly ubiquitous in the US. It was first issued in 1980 as a catalogue exclusive. It came in a mailer box without any packaging, but it did come with this shaped insert that would always sort of follow the outline of the case and be printed both sides with action figures. In the remaining few years, it was reissued 7 times. So it gives you some idea as to why it's probably one of the things that most kids in America eventually got hold of. So between 1980 and 1983, there were, as I say, 7 different reissues. And all of these came with a different, what they call a skirt. So it came with a little cardboard sleeve that sat on the, if you imagine it sitting on Vader's shoulders and coming around the base. So that would change. The stickers which came with the set would change to reflect the latest waves, and the inserts would also change to reflect the range at that time. So, you know, they are pretty kind of worthless loose, but they get more desirable if you start to factor in some of these various cards and skirts and inserts and stickers, and they sort of get sort of a sense of completeness, then they become a little bit more desirable to collectors. However, in the UK, it was only available as a Palatoy mail away, and that's how I first encountered this thing. It was advertised on full page ads in things like Marvel, Star Wars Weekly, 2000 AD. And of course, if you want to see one of these, there's one in our Lookin blog, which is dated the 25th of July, 1981. If you were going to add that to your collection, look out for the one with Prince Charles and Lady Di on the cover. So yeah, in the UK, it was a mail away only thing, although I have heard people say that they saw them on shelves, and maybe that was part of some Kenner overstock in later in the line. But certainly it was only ever intended to be a mailer. I have seen them complete with a Palatoy mail away box, but not very many. I think that's a very rare occurrence to find a Palatoy one in its mailer case. But it gets interesting when we get into the pre-production of its follow-up, which was the C-3PO case. So for those people in the States who were ahead of the game with this thing. A lot of these items came to light and exist in very impressive collections because they are interesting and intriguing items. So when they were creating the C-3PO case, they used the Darth Vader cases at Kenner to just test how well the vacuum metallization process would take to these things, how robust it would be when they were mailed and shipped around. And it's one of these that was just made an absolute star of the collecting world when it appeared on Star Wars From Concept to Screen to Collectible by Steve Sansweet, who we've had on the show before and talks at length about this book. But, you know, that was the first time I saw this gold Vader collector's case. And it's like, what is that? And it turns out it's a pre-production piece and one of several that range from, you know, the white mold test version, the dull gold version, and this glorious, you know, bright gold. It's like the Indiana Jones icon from Raiders. It's this amazing piece, and I'm sure it would be the centerpiece in anyone's collection. So as far as iconic Vader items go, it's certainly up there.
Cheers, mate. Yeah, I've got a completely beaten up one, which I can't remember when I got. I think most collectors who have been around for a while have managed to acquire one. If I were a betting man, I'd say we'd all have one.
I still got my original one.
Yeah,
brilliant. It's got stickers on the back from the cinema from when I went to see Return of the Jedi, and it's the fun products ones, the ones that are sort of little arch-shaped, and they've got some Jedi characters, and there's sort of three arranged on the back, sort of in a triangle to sort of mirror the shape. So yeah, my original childhood one is still there with the stickers of the figures I had at the time, which is
brilliant.
Proved to be a good reference.
And the little accessory box, nice.
Yeah.
What about you, Stu? Dan? I'm sure you must have one.
I have a nice one in a collar. It's got all the collar with it. And I think I've got an extra couple of inserts that I've picked up over the years of the, you know, they've got the character inserts of, you know, with the figures you can collect. So I've picked a few variations of that up and I've kept them all inside of it. That was, I think, from me and Ian Sanderson back in the day. But I've had so many. When you pick up job lots of figures, the amount of times I picked up a Vader carry case.
But they're brilliant, aren't they? Just having it on a shelf. Again, it's that sort of imposing helmet just looking down. I think they're great. Quite an underrated piece, and then they don't break the bank.
We actually had one as a kid. Like I say, my Star Wars toys were handed down to me, but it's strange. It was always knocking around, but our figures were always kept in an old ice cream tub. So, you know, I don't ever remember the figures being in it. It was just this head that seemed to knock around bedroom to bedroom kind of thing. But I've owned many in collections. I would love one, like a nice proper one, same with 3PO head, but I've never got around to buying it. I've got one on display, Jez. I think you were the person that put it where it is and it's still there.
That's teamwork.
Teamwork.
Brilliant. Right, now before we go on to the next part of the show, something occurred to me earlier on which rarely gets mentioned on podcasts. Snatch wars. Now, what do I mean by snatch wars?
I'm not sure this is the right show.
I love snatch wars. I was watching it the other day.
Can you explain, can you describe what snatch wars is, Dan, for those people who might not be aware?
So there was a movie, Guy Ritchie movie, sequel to Lock, Stock and Barrel, Two Smoking Barrels. I think it came out in 2000, called Snatch. And there's a character in there called Bricktop, who likes to feed his victims to pigs. He's a East End gangster. And he uses lots of colourful language. And there's, someone was inventive enough to take Bricktop's dialogue and edit it into a number of scenes, replacing James L. Jones with Bricktop. I don't think I can quote any of the lines from it.
No, you can't. you can't quote any lines, but it's just, put a sock in it, Turkish. It's just brilliant. It's if you're in a bad mood or if you're in a low mood or things just getting you down, just put on Snatch Wars. Don't worry. It is fine. Get a Snatch Wars on YouTube and you'll watch this because you would have never seen Darth Vader scenes like this. It goes on for about 7 minutes or so. It's brilliant. But yeah, good fun. Bricktop, played by Alan Ford. And definitely just worthy of mention in our Darth Vader episode.
What have you got to tell me that's so f***ing important? aboard?
There's no one on board, sir. According to the log, the crew abandoned ship right after takeoff.
Good. That takes care of one little piggy. Now find me the silly sods who blagged the bookies. Find them today.
Get me a scanning crew in here on the double. I want every part of this ship checked.
So lads, Darth Vader, amazing as we know. Now I'm already guessing, Dan's already put it out there, that it's probably the most dominant figure in my collection. I look around my Beyond the Toys stuff, and a good proportion of it is Darth Vader. Now, what have you got in your collection? What particular things do you like or stand out, or what else have you seen that's available online?
The answer to that question is the earlier stuff is always more interesting than the later stuff, which we've already discussed in terms of how the way things are merchandise have changed. So, you know, I've got a few of my favourites, and they all seem to fall in that first movie era. So the first thing I'm going to bring to the table is a kind of two-part Beyond the Toys item. And it starts with a company called H.C. Ford, or HCF, who were a UK producer of novelty items and stationery, who took over the license to produce Star Wars stationery from Helix in the UK. And they produced a Star Wars branded line in 1982 that had a decidedly Empire Strikes Back flavour. And as part of this big range of stationery, they produced 6 pencil toppers. What's notable about these is rather than referencing the movie characters, these are clearly based on the action figures. So we've got Luke X-Wing, we've got Chewbacca, we've got Han Hoth with his hood up and goggles on his head, we've got Yoda with a snake around his shoulders, R2 with the big central round blue eye and a sticker body. But most remarkably is the Darth Vader is moulded with a sleeveless vinyl cape with his arms straight by his side, with a lightsaber emitting straight from his right hand. And it's quite clearly based on the action figure. 1983, the following year, saw a new set of toppers that were created for Return of the Jedi, of which 5 were new, but this crazy Vader. It persisted. It was repeated in the line. Now, here's a question for you. Does anyone know how to tell a 1982 H.C. Ford pencil topper from a 1983 one?
Enlighten me. Yeah. I've got one in my hand now. I've got a Vader in front of me.
So the 1983 one is taller. So the one you've got, Dan, do you have anything to compare it to?
I've only got one. So no. It's probably about the first two, about half the size of my index finger. That's any help. I don't know how much taller one is than the other.
That probably really helps, Craig, because index fingers are all the same.
Terrible gauge.
I don't know. What is he next to? He's probably... Oh, I forgot I can stand him against.
Oh, dear.
Yeah. Well, I think my career in dial-up valuations and identification has stalled at the first hurdle.
Well, hold on then. Let's go with the cameras. Hold on, I'm going to switch my camera on.
I'm going to have to go and get a couple now.
Hang on. There he is. Oh.
Okay. Now I'm going to guess that that is an Empire one.
I hope so.
Then good name.
This is going to come
back now. All mine are behind.
Yeah, none of us.
Just pull it back a little bit. I think that's a 1982 one.
Good.
So it's your Empire one. So it fits beautifully in your collection, Dan.
Very nice, Craig.
Good. Is this now good podcasting?
You sent me a picture, actually, of the Empire one on top of the Jedi one. And the two of them on top of each other are almost the height of a 3¾-inch figure. What is that very large sort of ceramic thing to the left of it?
Well, I think a pencil topper, based on an action figure, is cool enough. But this gets another level of abstraction with a ceramic money box that's based on the pencil topper that was based on the action figure. And there's also a similar one for Chewbacca. Now, these are widely considered to be bootlegs, and you never see them really attributed to any specific maker. But the stoppers, you're lucky, and it's not been swapped around with another one over time, are stamped with R Moss Limited. Whether that is the manufacturer of the money box itself or whether it's the manufacturer of the plastic stopper is a little bit up for debate. But if Etsy and eBay are to be believed, there's quite a collector's market for RMOS items, and these all tend to be really cheap looking money boxes from the 70s and 80s. So this company is also responsible for money boxes of Dusty Bin and very dodgy looking ETs and Postman Pat banks. They're probably produced by a company that was enterprising enough to just smash a few out. And, you know, the things I've read about these in various groups, forums and things sort of suggest they were that very low end sort of fairground seaside type novelty. But I think, you know, if I had to pick a favorite Vader item for my collection, I think this curious little Vader with its 1 and 2 degrees of separation from the original figure are just a really nice little sidebar to Star Wars collecting.
Lovely. Thanks for that, mate. Dan, you shared some pictures of some Darth Vader badges, and that took yourself and Craig down a little sort of rabbit warren of discussion and discovery.
Yeah, so I think we're probably all familiar with factors, or at least heard of them. I just had them kind of penned as just they'd made a handful of badges and that was it. But there were a lot more through research just for this little bit now that they're involved in a lot more. So I've been collecting fan club items now for probably the last 5 or 6 years. I've got a full run of Banff for tracks. I've got a nice patch display. I'd stayed away from the factors patches just because they weren't really fan club, but I've come to discover that Factors actually printed and manufactured a lot of the stuff that was sold by the fan club. So it's all kind of connected. So Factors were based in Delaware out in the States, and they were one of the very first Star Wars licensees. And they, obviously the easiest thing, you know, while these toys were being designed and manufactured out in the Far East, the easiest thing to produce was T-shirts. So they produced initially a range of T-shirts, one of which was Darth Vader rather than Darth Vader Lives. And I just always assumed that this was kind of some kind of knockoff or bootleg item, but this was an official release. I was looking through the Star Wars Vault book last night by our good friend Steve Stansweet. Apparently I'm a fanboy, Stu. And there was a promotional image of several Star Wars characters. I think there's a Stormtrooper, R2-D2, C-3PO, Chewbacca and Darth Vader, all in, you know, costumes from, I don't know if they were screen news, but they were, you know, high quality costumes for back then. So you've got to assume they've come from Lucasfilm, each wearing a T-shirt, and Darth Vader is wearing the Darth Vader Lives. So how the hell this got through marketing and signed off with this glaring spelling mistake, who knows? But they produced it on a number of items. So you've got the badge that everyone's probably familiar with, which came in two sizes. You've got the large size badge and then the smaller version. There was a patch that was released carded, and also this T-shirt. So it was kind of, yeah, across the board. And then you had another and Craig, you might be able to help me with the name of the company. There was another range of badges with the Star Wars logo in the corner, saying Aberdeen Associates or someone, was it, who released that short run of
Bennett,
badges?
I think there were Bennett's of Glasgow.
Bennett's of Glasgow, got my Scottish cities mixed up, who also released it with this spelling mistake on. So you've got, yeah, this Darth Vader Lives, and it's, you know, whenever you go to any of these Star Wars reference books, certainly the Sansweet's one, he's constantly calling this out, this spelling mistake. It's quite funny it got through, and it's an officially licensed item. And on when I was looking through the Star Wars collector's archive, someone's actually called out, I think it was, let me just find it now. They've called out a badge, an actual bootleg badge, where it says Darth Vader is alive and well. So it's actually spelt Vader correctly on the bootleg badge. But then they've, at the very bottom, rather than writing Star Wars, they've done a star symbol with Wars next to it. It's a very peculiar badge, but a really good image of him. So yeah, it's obviously people were having a poke at the official item, getting the spelling wrong.
So bootleg spells it right, official spells it wrong.
And correct.
As you said, you've got the image then of Darth Vader wearing that T-shirt. Is that right?
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's not the only time we've seen Darth Vader wear clothing. So I dug out earlier on the Christmas, comic, 25p. Number 28, December the 28th, 1983. You've got Darth Vader wearing a Christmas hat, a Christmas jacket or a Santa suit on top of his outfit, and gloves. Red gloves handed out presents. Luke's got one from Dad, and Han's got one from Uncle Darth. So, yeah. Aww. Great little spot. And,
The other thing just to point out, so is in the, I don't know if you've got the Star Wars vault, there's lots of kind of little inserts and stuff in there, and there is a t-shirt transfer on there, and the one that's in there has got, it's a logo error, one that I don't know if it ever made it out to market, but I think the point that Steve Sansweet was trying to make was they corrected the logo on this. I think it's the one with Darth Vader's helmet with almost a TIE fighter flying through it, so there was an incorrect logo that was used, and they corrected it, but they never corrected the Darth Vader lives. But yeah, nice item with a funny spelling mistake. You don't often see many of those. Maybe Wookiee being spelled incorrectly, but yeah, I don't think there's any examples of a Vader. I wonder how many arguments it caused on the playground about the correct spelling of Darth Vader.
It's a great item. It comes from those days when like slogan badges were a real thing, like I Shot JR, this idea that Darth Vader lives, because the last time we saw him was spinning off, you know, and his fate was not 100% confirmed. It's just sort of people engaging in the narrative. Lovely.
And that's still now on the latest generations with the whole Ahsoka lives, which you hear people screaming at every celebration and stuff, and you get old Filoni out. Brilliant. Now, before we jump on, just going through my own little collection, I don't know where to begin with regards to Vader stuff. There's a few things which I absolutely love. The only miscarded item of Star Wars which I have is a Star Wars, what should be, a pencil sharpener. And it says it on the packaging, Star Wars Figurine Collecting Series Pencil Sharpener. But it's actually a tape dispenser. Now this is the Stuart Hall company, the Butterfly Originals. And the Cherry Hill. So yeah, Stuart Hall. We've all seen this sort of stuff. Standard stationery bits and pieces. But yeah, a tape dispenser, but marked up as a pencil sharpener. I love that. And then safety metal blade scissors. So this is scissors with little sort of holographic, I'm not quite sure what these things are, where the picture changes is just as you look at it on a different angle. It's got Vader's helmet and then Shuttle Tidarian. And yeah, so these are scissors with metal blades for ages 3 years and up. There's no way I would give these to a three-year-old kid. But there we go, different times, all good stuff. But I think the big one, I don't know how to choose it. I ordered these two when I was in Afghanistan. So both of these items got sent from America to Afghanistan. The first one is the Darth Vader Wilton Party Pan, which is an Empire Strikes Back piece. So it's a sort of aluminium or aluminium Empire Strikes Back character. So fill this up and you've got a Darth Vader cake face. And yeah, it's absolutely brilliant. I've not seen one of these in the UK before, and it's stunning. But the other one, which is the massive Darth Vader speakerphone. So that's a really, really cool piece, which I am going to get fitted up to the UK system. So it's American Telecommunications Corporation, the Darth Vader statuette sort of speakerphone. It's brilliant. But one of the things which is weird about this packaging is whilst it says Darth Vader speakerphone, it doesn't have any other Star Wars logos, racetrack, nothing really associating it with Star Wars. Now I say that, I'm going to look at it on every single side. So yeah, on one side, you've got a picture of Darth dueling with Luke. Just says Darth Vader speakerphone on the front, Darth Vader speakerphone. Again, Luke and Vader dueling. Yeah, nothing at all on this saying Star Wars or Jedi or Empire. But it came out in 1983. But it's just a brilliant piece. I guess the other thing which I've got, which I think is really cool, is the Ben Cooper fun poncho mask and hood, which is a really strange thing. It looks like the sort of poncho you'd get at Alton Towers or Drayton Manor if you're on the log flume. But yeah, a big yellow poncho with some sort of dastardly mask and Darth Vader with Star Wars on the front of it. Absolutely brilliant. So, wonderful stuff. What about you guys? What else have you got?
In our attempts to bring structure and order to this section where we flip-flop around different ways of doing it. One of the things you challenged me with was finding a top Vader-inspired consumable product. So I guess by consumable, we mean something that you use it up and wear it out. If I don't get a nice sound drop in the end.
Yeah, use it up and wear it out. And I didn't mean a pen topper as well, in addition to your pen topper.
So I was going to go with the Helix Vader eraser, as I always feel that his steampunk gauges on his chest plate are worthy of greater admiration. But we've already done a bit of stationery, and Vader has always done particularly well in the bathroom category here. So a couple of notable mentions. So one to the Addis Skittle bubble bath bottle from the UK, and its US contemporary, which was the more figural Omni shampoo and bubble bath container that was released at the same time, and the awesome store display that accompanied that. And there were a couple. There was an R2-D2 kind of inspired one with a dome and polystyrene shelves, but there was also another one that had probably the best use of that rapper Vader, where he's got his arms folded and he's flanked by his Royal Guard DJs. It's just a stunning piece, and we'll put some images of that on the enhanced. But it was the UK Clyro range from 1978, which just for me is a beautiful thing. It features some really, really stunning original illustrations of Vader across the whole range, but he features on his own label of both a standard shaped bottle of bubble bath, but also as this wonderfully naive blow molded figural bottle. He's got a giant head and tiny legs, and it's just a lovely thing that comes in this gorgeous window box that, should you ever flatten one out, reveals Vader in this Saturday Night Fever pose with his finger in the air, and it's just a great piece, absolutely packed with charm and just the essence of that era. And if you open the bottles, the smell of that era as well. And I know that the wacky copywriting for these have featured on other podcasts before now, but it never gets old. So here's what it says on the bubble bath box. Have a wicked wallow in Darth Vader's gorgeous galactic bubbles. Let his extrasensory power wash over you. And don't worry, you will come out shining like a Jedi Knight. Just pour one capful under the force of your taps. Isn't that wonderful?
You love all that, don't you?
I just think it's
so 70s.
Charming, you know. And I think we've lost a lot of that with the, you know, the structure and the rigidity of corporate guidelines these days. It's nice that this stuff is there. It's nice it exists.
Yeah, the other item I picked out, this will be, I'm coming in left field with this one, is the Darth Vader in Flames, the cast and crew items that they had and subsequently re-released in the fan club. So you've got the, you know, the guys that when they were out in Norway all had the patches on their arm with a Darth Vader in Flames kind of, it's got like a semicircle on the top and it's squared off at the bottom. It's got the Empire Strikes Back logo, some flames in the Darth Vader mask. So that made it onto, obviously, the patch. There was a sticker release for it. And they also used a similar image for the Happy Empire Day badge they gave out at cinemas when Empire was originally released in the UK. But yeah, I think it's such a great little image when you think how Darth Vader ends up at the end of Return of the Jedi. It kind of foreshadows some of that as well.
Brilliant. Craig, hey, I love that finger in the air. Like it's on Saturday Night Fever. That, do you know what? I'd seen all that, but I hadn't necessarily noticed that because it's dark on a bit of a sort of dark background. And I think I was looking at the rest of the packaging. The fact that you've just highlighted that hand up, the finger up, like he's sort of, I don't know, Kipchoge finishing the marathon or someone's Saturday Night Fever. I think it's brilliant. I absolutely love it. Really do.
It's not something you would notice because it's on three sides of the design. So it's only... You know, I think I was scanning it for record's sake or something, and I noticed it. I just thought, somebody's really thought about that.
No, it's cool. Dan, there was one other thing which you shared, wasn't there?
So the Arkhamus Darth Vader costume. So I think it's very similar to the costume you called out, Jez. It's sort of like a poncho, but I think it's less of a just a wearable poncho. Then it's got all the graphics of Vader's costume on the front of it. Now, I've got a photo of me wearing this somewhere when I would have probably been 4 or 5. I remember getting it for Christmas. It comes with a nice Darth Vader mask. I had a little lightsaber, must have been some sort of knockoff one I had as a kid, and I would not take that thing off. All the it's all kind of like a vinyl plastic and it all tore away. But yeah, I picked up one of these, I think it was last year, and yeah, it's a great little thing. I'm not brave enough to try it on though, because I think I'm tempted to, but yeah, I don't want to do a kind of a before and after.
Yeah, see, now you've just said that, I was like, well, maybe I could crack out my Star Wars fun poncho. But that's like, you know, you graded, isn't it? I don't want to do that. This is sealed. Yeah. The packaging is failing.
Mine's pretty beat up. The box itself, the window's pushed in a little bit. But it's really interesting. Again, it's, you know, the UK design, what they've included on this. I mean, on the top of it, it's got the Star Wars Empire Strikes Back and Return of the Jedi logos. It's using an image of Darth Vader on one side. It looks like it's from Empire Strikes Back. Never seen that used on any packaging. And the back of it, it's got there all the other ones that are available. So there was a C-3PO, a Chewbacca, and a Stormtrooper. Yeah, one size fits all, apparently, Jez, so I might be able to get into them.
I'm sure somebody will correct me if I'm wrong on this, but I believe that there are two variations on that box. So there's the one with the, yeah, there's one, the Empire-style one, which I have seen associated with the Australian market.
Right.
And then the other one with the Star Wars logo, which seems to fall in line with the ones that are more sort of the UK full range of characters.
Yeah. I'm not normally into this sort of thing, but because I did remember having this one as a, getting this on Christmas Day one year, I've picked it up. But yeah, it's nice.
I mean, we've gone through some great things. We've gone through, you know, some of the stuff Bill was saying about what he's got and the challenge he sets people of trying to find stuff which they haven't put Vader on or Vader doesn't feature on, you know, golf clubs, checkbooks, condoms. Vader is everything. I mean, from a focus point of view, it's incredible. Luke Wilkinson has just shared with me a two-pack. So Star Wars Return of a Jedi, two-pack, Vader and a Jawa. So to get two first 12 figures, I mean, you rarely get one first 12. They're generally Return of the Jedi figures. So to get a Vader and a Jawa on one of those is incredible. It's really, really good. So that's an awesome one of Luke's. And I've also seen a really sweet miss card online, which was Darth Vader on a Chewbacca card, which is pretty cool. You know, there's so many great things out there. But did you guys see the post which Pete Filmer put on?
The little booties. The little
yeah. I love these. I was really tempted myself, quite frankly. Here they are. Oh, these are amazing. 1970s Darth Vader booties. These small booties, which measure about 5.5 inches long, were sold in supermarkets, drugstores, etc. back in the 70s. It's unclear if these 20th Century Fox had actually licensed these at the time. There is some evidence to suggest they may have, but there is no mark or brand on them. To my knowledge, there was a C-3PO version and a Chewbacca version as well. It's a great early item that rarely comes up. So, oh, he has edited it. Upon closer inspection, I did find the 20th Century Fox trademark on the back of the helmets. Oh, wow. So, yeah, these are bright blue booties, which look like they should be in Monsters, Inc. or something or other. And then they've got a big 3D Vader's helmet with matching blue lenses on them. I mean, they're tiny, but they're absolutely wonderful. And they've just sold earlier, a few hours ago, for $250. But yeah, absolutely stunning. Absolutely brilliant. I love them. Yeah, really cool.
Yes, your thoughts betray you. Your feelings for them are strong.
So Craig, Generation Skywalker, as you know, all eras, all passions, all Star Wars. We don't just do podcasts, do unboxings, do the enhanced shows, but you're also a dab hand at the blogs. Now, without giving too much away, what's your latest blog about? Cue Vader.
Yeah, well, it's a blog post inspired by a little bit of research I did after stumbling on an unusual image of Darth Vader in the 1979 Palatine calendar. So this is a really cool onset photo of Vader that's been shot through an open door as he strides through Tantive IV. And I think it's really up there with some of the classic stills from the first movie, but it's just not, it's not a famous Star Wars image, and got me thinking as to why. So this blog kind of ponders its origins, but it also looks at what makes it a good image. And then it goes down a little bit of a rabbit hole into some of the geometric symbolism within this image and other famous images like it. So what on earth do I mean by geometric symbolism? You'll have to go and have a read. As a blog, it's quite short by my standards, and you can find it if you visit generationskywalker.com and you go to the blog section in the top navigation bar and follow the drop-down menu to Lost Vader Images. Have a look, tell me what you think, see if you agree with me. I think it's a great image.
Impressive. Most impressive. You and I discussed it offline, shared a couple of images, and yeah, it's great. So I can really encourage people to go and check it out. Craig, thanks so much for that. Your blogs are always knocking out of the park.
Cheers.
So it's time now for us to go back to Bill McBride, where I put him on the spot with some rapid fire questions. So here we go, Bill. Rapid fire round. I'm just going to throw a few questions at you, and we'll see how this goes. All right, then. Are you ready?
I am ready.
Good stuff. Carded figures. How many do you think you have?
110,
115. Roger that. What's your favorite one, and why?
Power of the Force Vader. Standard. I just love the aesthetics of the card. I think the card design, everything about it is just beautiful. It's, I'd want to have a poster of it.
Favorite Vader line?
Wow, that's a good one. I don't know. I have you now.
Perfect. Easy. I bet you say that every time you get something new in your collection as well. But I digress. Right. What's your favorite Darth Vader consumable?
There was, well, I've never tried it, but there's Darth Vader beer. From 1978.
Ooh, I bet that's got a kick. Okay. What's your favorite Vader scene?
The end of Empire after Luke and Vader fight on Bespin, and Luke's getting taken away on the Millennium Falcon, and Vader is just looking out the window in the Star Destroyer. And it's just one of those like surreal moments. He reaches out through the Force, and he's just calling to Luke. Yeah, definitely that one.
What's your favorite piece of Darth Vader themed clothing?
Japanese motorcycle jacket from 1999. The company only did, I think, 200 of those. It's a beautiful piece, all leather, embroidered. So that's definitely my favorite Vader wearable.
Awesome. What's your favorite piece of Darth Vader themed ceramics?
It's actually a ceramic copy of the 15-inch Vader. That was done. I've never found the manufacturer, but it's actually a lamp. So it's the 15-inch Star Tier figure, but it's solid ceramic, and functions as a lamp. So definitely that one.
Brilliant. And to end this rapid fire round, crazy, absolute. What's the most sort of? What's your craziest, most bonkers piece of Vader sort of memorabilia?
I think that would be the actual. It was like a Japanese kind of a gumball machine that they use at retail that actually, instead of dispensing candy, they were tiny balls that actually had little toys in them. This thing is crazy. It's actually like a retail piece, 100%. It was never intended for consumers. But the thing is like three feet tall. It's got a huge, you know, Vader helmet on the top. That's probably the one of the ones I'll put out, and just people just like, they just can't figure it out. So yeah, that one's definitely one of the crazier ones.
Brilliant. Thank you so much, Bill. That's your rapid fire round over. Bill, once again, thank you so much.
Good work, Commander.
So this time of the show that I'd be saying what next month's figures are. But I think this is going to be next week's figures or figures in 10 days or so. Because as you know, we should also this month be doing the Emperor's Royal Guard, the Imperial Dignitary, and the Emperor. So that will be on show 17. Right, now over to you, listeners. What did we miss? What did you find interesting? Who wants to come on the next show? Who should? Contact us at generationskywalker@gmail.com. We are all over social media. We've got Generation Skywalker on TikTok, Instagram, Twitter, Facebook, and we also have our dedicated We Are Generation Skywalker group on Facebook. We do various unboxings and Skywalker blasts. You can check out everything on Generation Skywalker's YouTube channel, or even send us a voice message at generationskywalker@gmail.com. Now I must say thank you so much to Bill McBride for giving up so much of his time to come on and talk to us about his collecting. Bill, it was absolutely brilliant to have you on board. And thank you so much to Mark Andrews and Jamie Acott with the Variant Villains for giving us the lowdown on Darth Vader.
The Force is strong in this one.
If this is the first time you've listened to Those Old Fossils, have a little look at our back catalogue. Go back and listen. Start at the most recent and work backwards. Lock in Generation Skywalker. There is so much to listen to, so subscribe to them all and just, yeah, delve in. All eras, all passions, all Star Wars. Get amongst it.
With our combined strength, we can end this destructive conflict and bring order to the galaxy.
So, it's goodbye from Dan.
Cheerio!
It's goodbye from Stu.
See you later.
And it's goodbye from Craig.
See you in a few days.
It's goodbye from me. We are Generation Skywalker. All eras, all passions, all Star Wars.